Good morning, everyone, and welcome to the 20th meeting of the Rural Affairs and Islands Committee in 2024. And I hope everybody had a relaxing and enjoyable summer recess. Just before we begin, could please ensure that all electronic devices are switched to silent, including my own. Our first item of business is to consider whether to take item 3 in private. Are we all agreed? We are agreed, thank you. Our next item of business today is a roundtable discussion as part of our pre-budget scrutiny for the upcoming Scottish Budget 2025-26. And the committee has agreed to focus attention on the Marine Directorate budget to identify if it has the resources required to fully undertake its functions. And this morning we're joined by 8 marine stakeholders, so thank you all for joining us. So we have about two and a half hours for this session. Given that we've got quite a few participants, can I ask everyone to be succinct in their questions and their answers? And if you could just indicate by waving your hand or give me a look if you wish to participate at any point. If you feel that your only contribution is to agree what was already been said, if you could just say that you agree rather than repeating the points, that would be most helpful. And likewise, if you're asked to contribute to a part of the discussion that don't relate to your area of expertise, please don't feel that you need to contribute to every question. So before we start, I'm going to ask everyone to introduce themselves. So on my right.
Yeah, I'm Robin Cook. I'm currently working at the University of Strathclyde as a senior research fellow. But my background is as a fishery scientist, and most of my career was spent at the Marine Laboratory in Aberdeen. I worked mostly on demersal fish, but ultimately I was the director of what was then Fishery Research Services for a number of years.
Thank you. Can I just say to everyone that we have got a gentleman here that actually works all your mics, so you won't actually need to touch any buttons to speak. Next, Alistair.
Good morning. I'm Alistair Hamilton. I'm the chair of the Northwest Region of Inshore Fisheries Group. We represent skippers. I'm a former skipper and also have worked in fisheries management for many years.
Good morning, my name is Michael Kaiser. I'm currently the acting co-director of the Lyell Centre based at Heriot Watt University. Like Robin, I'm a fisheries scientist, worked in fisheries over 33 years, started my career though working at the Centre for Environment, Fisheries and Aquaculture Science, so the equivalent of the Marine Lab, but down south of the border, and have collaborated with the Marine Lab for many years. But here today I'm representing the Marine Alliance for Science and Technology Scotland, which is a collaboration across all the universities in Scotland in the marine space.
Thank you.
Good morning. I'm Elspeth MacDonald. I'm the Chief Executive of the Scottish Fishermen's Federation. SFF represents 8 fishermen's associations across different fleet sectors in Scotland and also across different parts of the Scottish geography. I have been in this role for around 5 years now, and I did actually start my working life back in the Marine Laboratory a very long time ago, and I left there in 2001, so much will have changed since then. Thank you.
Good morning, I'm Charles Miller. I'm the Executive Director of the Sustainable Inshore Fisheries Trust, which is a Scottish charity focusing on sustainable fisheries in the inshore waters.
Good morning, I'm Colin Moffat. I currently am a visiting professor at Robert Gordon University and hold an honorary position at Heriot Watt. I was, until 2021, the Chief Scientific Advisor Marine to Scottish Government, and prior to that I was Head of Science at Marine Scotland. My main research interests are in terms of the human activities, consequences on marine systems, including climate change, pollution, and fisheries. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Phil Taylor. I'm the director of Open Seas. We're a campaigns organisation working for healthier seas, more sustainable seafood and public good from the public commons that is our seas. I just want to thank the committee for taking evidence on this important issue at this time.
Thank you.
Hi everyone, I'm Alan Wells. I'm the Chief Executive of Fisheries Management Scotland, which is the representative body for Scotland's District Salmon Fishery Boards and Charitable Rivers and Fisheries Trusts. I suspect I'm a bit of an outlier at today's session because we cover things in freshwater and marine and everything that goes on land as well. So whilst wild salmon and recreational fisheries are part of the Marine Directorate budget, the issues we need to address to protect and restore river catchments and fish species go a lot wider than that. So in our evidence, we did talk about forestry grant scheme, agriculture, things like that. I'll try to stick with marine today, but can't promise I won't diverge at times.
Thank you.
My name is Elaine White. I'm the Executive Secretary of the Clyde Fishermen's Association. Clyde Fishermen's Association is one of the oldest fishing associations in Scotland, and I have been in the job for nearly 10 years.
Thank you. Thank you all very much, and you're most welcome. Thank you for taking the time to come today. We've got a number of themes that we're going to cover in our evidence session today, and we're going to kick off with the Marine Directorate budget overview. So what I would like to ask is how such events as EU exit, the COVID pandemic, climate and biodiversity change have increased or changed the pressure on the Marine Directorate's budget and resources, and what should their key priorities in 2025-26 be and beyond. But also I'd like to ask whether, given that the budgets were increased as part of EU exit, whether those budget increases actually did manage to deal with the new challenges of managing fisheries post-Brexit, and whether the CFP policies have indeed been successfully delivered. I'll kick off with Elaine.
I think it's been a challenging time for lots of sectors since the last few years, COVID, etc., as well as leaving the EU has meant a bit of a change. But I do think that the actual core work of Marine Scotland is changing as we're seeing new sectors coming in, and we're seeing fisheries, as you can see from the budget, reducing the investment, and that's our key area. But I also think there's a different culture now. One thing that I was looking at before I came here was that there was a 1,911 Freedom of Information requests and EIRs between, I think it was November 2022 and August 2024. That works out at 7.5 years full-time of answering FOIs in only just over 18 months. So I do worry that any increases to the budget is maybe being pulled in different directions, and we aren't seeing that being related to the core work that we absolutely have to do. The other thing that I would just point out as well is obviously there's been a very big increase in compliance in comparison to other sectors. But the budget for science, which I think is the most important thing for us, certainly, is remain fairly static. It's actually 14.7 million now. Well, the actual spend on compliance is about just under 29 million. And I think that that's something worth talking about how we legislate and how we actually gather evidence. Thanks.
And also, you know, given your position, do you think that the Marine Directorate has managed to get through the challenges of EU exit, and have the new policies successfully been delivered or in the course of being delivered?
I feel that we're in a time of flux, and I feel that that's certainly reflected. I think we feel that we probably have less contact with staff and that staff have more pressure on them. If I have to go back 10 years ago, a phone call to a member of staff would be something that you would do to sort out an issue. That's far more difficult now. Obviously, the advance of online meetings, etc., might mean that people are less accessible generally in work, but I genuinely think that the workload is going up, but the productivity is probably going down.
Okay, thank you. Phil?
Yeah, thank you. I just wanted to touch on the point around EU exit. So, as you said, the Common Fisheries Policy is no longer entirely competent in the UK law, and instead there is the UK Fisheries Act, which was passed in 2020 and brought into Scottish legislation via Fergus Ewing's legislative consent motion at the time. That establishes a series of fisheries objectives. Now, those are things that range from the national benefit objective, you know, core economic objective, to things such as the ecosystem objective, achieving ecosystem health. So it's a real place where we can balance out the different desires for our fisheries and for our seas. Of course, ours are quite focused on environment and sustainability, but it's where that balance happens. The key vehicle for delivering those is what's called the fisheries management plans. So these are per stock or per species fisheries management plans. And the Scottish Government Marine Directorate set out in the Joint Fisheries Statement, which you remember was submitted to you as committee for approval, 22 such fisheries management plans which were to be delivered. Now, this is part of that justification for the increase in funding, you know, the additional obligations that were the Cabinet Secretary at the time indicated that were being put on them. We have yet to see a draft of any of those, and the deadline for delivery of them is the end of this year. That's in the Joint Fisheries Statement, so it has a legal standing. If they are not to meet those, they have to take certain legal actions. There's a section in the UK Fisheries Act which they must comply with. We've been involved in the process of sort of drafting some of these, and sadly, the proposals that we've seen on the table, the drafts we've seen on the table, I don't think would pass muster with the duties of that process. I don't think they achieve what those... they don't achieve the objectives, certainly, as a whole, but they also don't achieve the specifics of what is required there. So, sadly, I think that you asked how is the process of EU exit going and how is that sort of bringing back some of the power to UK fisheries administrations within what is a quite federal system at that point. I don't think it's going particularly well at this point. We're not seeing that progress. This is not early days. We're 4 years in. And so what should be the priority, convener, you'd asked, and I would suggest that this is one of the very significant priorities for the coming year, delivery of those duties. Thank you.
So do you think that's because there's a lack of resources, a lack of budget to get that work done? Is that where you think the issue lies?
I'm afraid, and I find it very difficult to engage with the budget here because it's too high level. So I don't know how the allocations are going, breaking down within teams. And I have to, you know, I trust that the Cabinet Secretary and her team have evaluated that to a significant degree and have come up with a proper resourcing regime. I'm not here to second guess those judgments. There is a lot of money in this system. Right, we are talking about very significant sums of money on these pieces of paper in front of us here. I think that there are other issues in the way. So, for example, with the fisheries management plans, Seafish were commissioned. I don't know in what kind of capacity, whether that was a contractual commission to draft that plan. And that plan that's come back is not in any real condition to take forward, in my opinion. That's in my opinion, of course. So I would question whether that resource, the money that has been used to commission Seafish, if indeed that's how it's worked, has been appropriately used, yes.
OK, thank you.
Thanks.
Michael, and then Elspeth.
I'm going to bring my age to bear here, because Phil's a little younger than me. So I think in answer to your question, the first thing to remember is that post-Brexit, we still have a scientific requirement to actually contribute to the science in relation to the management of the stocks that are managed at an EU level, of course, because fish do not respect boundaries. So we have to have our own scientific advice. So that workload still exists. But in addition to that, post-Brexit, obviously there has been an opportunity for the UK and the Scottish Government to be more ambitious in terms of how we actually manage our inshore waters and fish stocks there. And that has, of course, necessarily, and in a very timely way, created the need for an awful lot more work. So it's the existing workload plus a whole new raft of more work. If you look at the high-level budget, Phil quite rightly pointed out, it's very high-level. It actually only extends back to 2009. I was chatting with Robin beforehand. I first started my career in 1991. 1991, the Marine Lab in Aberdeen was somewhere that everybody would have liked to have worked in. It was internationally renowned, it was a science leader, and it was innovating. To be quite frank, these days it's not somewhere you'd want to work, because it's been systematically over three decades hollowed out to a former shell of what it was. So there's a shifting baseline here. So, you know, Phil's frustration are really a result of, you know, three decades of attrition of what was an excellent scientific resource. We're now left with a very pressurised group of staff who are trying to deal with even more work than they had on their plate beforehand. And that's not something you're going to fix in the space of 12 months. So the budget may have been increased, but actually there's a whole cultural reform required, and there's a rebuilding of the science resource that exists in Marine Scotland. And in addition to that, because the staff are so time pressured, it's left no headroom for them to actually draw on the excellent academic community that we do have in Scotland and use that more effectively. We're just not getting the engagement, and that's not because of a lack of desire, it's because of a lack of time for people to think and have free time to do that.
Okay, thank you. Elspeth.
Thank you, Convener. Yes, just adding to what's already been said, the budget may indeed have been increased post-leaving the EU, but of course there are many more policy and regulatory responsibilities that the Scottish Government now has. And I think a sense we have in SFF is that it feels like they're spinning an awful lot of plates, both across the policy machinery within the Marine Directorate and how that is underpinned by their scientific effort. So Phil is right in terms of the delay with the fisheries management plans. There is a legal obligation for those to be in place by the end of this year, and we've seen little of them so far. But we don't feel that they're not trying to do them. It's just they've got so many other priorities that they're trying to juggle. Now, not all of these priorities are things that have come from EU exit. So, for example, there's a lot of work that the government has decided to do on building a new national marine plan, for example. There's a lot of work now, a lot of effort in the Marine Directorate going into how they are dealing with the emerging landscape around offshore renewables and the environmental impacts of all of that. The government has published a blue economy vision and strategy. We've got all the policy priorities that came from the future fisheries management strategy, which I think was published back in 2020 or 2021. So it feels that they're spinning many, many plates, and what that feels like and looks like to us is that too little resources or what resource they have is being spread too thinly over too many things.
Alistair.
Thank you. I'm not going to echo. I'll go with your request. But I'd like to take it from a slightly different angle. I'm fairly new to this world. I've only come in a year ago from working abroad. So I don't know what happened pre-Brexit, so I can't really comment. But I would agree with what Elspeth says, what everybody says about spinning plates, about the jam being spread too thin. Certainly in science, the science facility seems to be shredded at the moment and hardly dealing with its statutory duties. Less so in compliance. And one of the management actions that I think is valid is that if you've got all the right policies about holistic management and ecosystem management and biodiversity, but if you're going to achieve these objectives, you wouldn't have the structure that we've got at the moment. The structure seems to be lagging behind. You've got the structure of an organisation that existed in the last 20 years trying to address new issues, and I think the budget could be better used if it was restructured somewhat.
Thank you. Colin, and then Charles.
Thank you very much, Convener. although we left the EU, we're still required to follow and determine good environmental status. And indeed, we're meant to be reporting this year on whether or not we achieved good environmental status in 2020. Now, I suspect, given the OSPAR quality status report that came out last year, the answer is going to be we haven't. And why is that critical? It's critical because if we don't have good environmental status, it impacts on our fisheries, it impacts on the whole environment. And so we have a problem there. But it does mean that we are still following through. We also have all the OSPAR commitments. They haven't changed either. And so, again, there's a lot of additional work. But one of my concerns is that under our national performance framework, we have three marine indicators. One on clean seas, and currently on our website, it tells us the facilities for the chemical analysis were lost due to Storm Arwen, and there'll be no further indicators until at least 2026. For our sustainable fish stocks, the most recent data highlighted is 2020, and for our biodiversity, it's 2018. We have to be working in real time, because the rate of change due to what's happening in terms of greenhouse gas emissions, ocean acidification, means we can't be using data that is that old. And so I think there's a lot of pressure on these people to deliver, but they're unable to because the facilities are not what they were. mean, they haven't done a lot of chemical analysis for quite some time. Ocean acidification is a potential problem, especially for our shell fisheries. And there's minimal data for Scotland. And yet some other countries have got very significant time series. So I'd echo also what Mike said, that we are a shadow of what we used to be. But the critical aspect is what that means is there's not the evidence. If we go to Scotland's Marine Assessment 2020, where there were significant recommendations put forward, I'm not aware that any of these recommendations have been enacted since that was published by Scottish Government. And so I think we have got a significant piece of work to do, because the rate of change is such that it's going to impact fisheries, it's going to impact every aspect of what it is that we are doing in the marine environment. And if we impact our marine environment adversely, we impact our terrestrial environment as well. And so consequently, I think that we need the evidence to be making sure we're making the right decisions on what human activities can take place where and when, and we don't have that.
Thank you. Charles.
Yeah. Thank you. I think Professor Moffat kind of touched on sort of the area I was going to go, which is, I mean, I totally agree about what's been said before about the spinning plates and the like and the resources being spread thin. But I think there's an important thing that hasn't actually been specifically mentioned, which is just around the whole issue of climate change and the responses that will be needed to react to that in terms of fisheries and marine management. So whilst we do have these hopefully non-recurring events like COVID, and there's a significant amount of work that needs to be done around reacting to and responding to what's come in under Brexit, there is still this overarching change which is taking place, which I think is a key issue in terms of sort of resourcing going forwards.
Alan.
So as it was said earlier on, it's kind of challenging to get a firm understanding of what these budget allocations actually mean on a sector-by-sector basis. It's particularly difficult in the case of salmon and recreational fisheries, I think. So what's actually more important to us as stakeholders is that resources are made available to deliver the commitments that have already been made. So the Wild Salmon Strategy, the Salmon Interactions Working Group. As far as I'm aware, there's no dedicated budget for those things at all. So we've worked hard and very grateful to have managed to get funding through Marine Fund Scotland to take forward some of those important things. But at the same time, the staff complement within the Wild Salmon and Recreational Fisheries team has fallen from 7 to 3. So we've stepped up, we're taking forward some of the recommendations or progressing some of those recommendations from the Wild Salmon Strategy. But without a dedicated budget to take these things forward, that's really challenging. It's really challenging for the staff in Marine Directorate. It's really challenging for our sector. So you mentioned Brexit. One of the things, as I understand it, the Marine Fund Scotland was a 3-year commitment by the UK government, and that commitment is now coming to an end. So it's imperative that we see that money coming forward because it's becoming increasingly important for taking forward important work. And I think there's probably an argument to think about ring-fencing some of that work in terms of, from our perspective, for things that are more towards conservation and addressing the biodiversity crisis, the wild salmon crisis, which is a subset of that. Because, as Colin says, these things are heading in one direction and we need to take concerted action to address them.
Thank you.
Robin?
Yes, I like others, it's difficult to, at this level of budget, to understand how that translates into actual delivery. But one of the real problems that the Marine Directorate Science people face is that all the research, or most of the research that they have been engaged in previously, is now finished, and there's no money to do research. And as a result, there's an inability to build capacity to deliver for the future. So on the one hand, although there are obviously pressing priorities to deliver on certain policy issues, the capacity to deliver in the future is being run down in order to address those things. And I think that it's extremely important that an element of the budget is allocated to allow people to do research, and also to allow Marine Directorate Science to benefit from funding which comes from elsewhere in order to support that research. In the days of the agency, it was possible to bring in external income, and that was additional money, which expanded the capacity to do stuff. Nowadays, it's not possible to do that. So if you're engaged in a project with external money, that money is not actually beneficial. It's not additional to the budget. So consequently, there's no incentive to do research benefiting from external work. So that cuts off networks of expertise in other institutions, and it means that the people involved are dependent on what they learned some years ago. And I think it's a real concern that in Scotland now, we no longer have a marine institute which has the capacity to deliver for the future. It's dependent only on what it learned 10 years ago.
Thank you. That's really helpful. Yeah, Michael.
If I could just add the comment, speaking as an academic at a university, it is essential that we have institutions like Marine Scotland Science, because they are there forever. Universities come and go. Academics like myself, we come and go. But institutions like Marine Scotland Science are permanent fixtures. And if you're going to build up long time series of data and data sets, they need to be curated. So you need to have that continuity. So you cannot expect this delivery to come solely from the academic community. We can contribute, and you know, we can contribute at different times and different things, but we're never going to provide the service that society needs. We can provide some of it, but not all of it. The other thing, Robin touched on this, you need to understand what has happened to Marine Scotland Science. Robin talked about the days of the agency. South of the border in England, they took a different approach with CFAS. CFAS became an executive agency. In contrast to Marine Scotland Science, CFAS has grown enormously because it has been allowed to expand its income streams to do work overseas, very successfully as well. And of course, it's using that additional income to subsidise the science and the research that it does on behalf of the UK taxpayer. So we've made a mistake somewhere in the past, and I'm afraid we're left with the consequences of that mistake today, and it's going to take some time to fix it.
Yes, I said in my earlier comments that there were a number of strategies that the government has published, and of course they have published a marine science and information strategy, I think it's called. And just, I think, sort of building on the points that Robin made, there's just this now mismatch between what the government wants to be and what it can be. So it talks in many of these strategy documents about being world class, about being internationally recognised, but there's a real mismatch between the ambition and what it says it wants to be and what it's actually enabling the Marine Directorate to be through the way in which it is now working and the way in which it is funded. I think I would very much echo the points about this decline in the international reputation and visibility internationally, a good example of which, so for example, mackerel is the most valuable stock for the Scottish fishing industry, accounts for more than a third of the value of total landings in Scotland. There used to be a really strong pelagic fisheries team in the Marine Laboratory. Now the stock assessment, which is a statutory requirement that has to be done. The stock assessment work on mackerel is now led by the Dutch. It's no longer led by people from the Marine Laboratory, where we have a huge vested interest in that fishery. So there's just been this erosion, this loss of international reputation. And I think whilst the government is projecting this desire to be an international leader, that is not being matched by the resources that are available.
I'm very conscious we're probably just moving off as the conversation goes on from the main topic. I'm going to bring in Colin, and then I'm going to go to an additional question from Ariane Burgess, but you'll all have an opportunity to contribute in other themes. Colin.
Thank you very much. There is one ecosystem monitoring site for Scotland, and that's off Stonehaven, run by the Marine Laboratory. Part of the challenge is that you need 15, 20 years of data in order to be able to differentiate between the natural fluctuations and the human forcing. And it's actually only in the last 5-10 years, because it started in 1997, that we've actually been able to use it. However, sampling analysis are slowing up, they're not happening. And so, again, these time series are not complete. And again, it's institutes like the Marine Laboratory that can keep these things going. Universities don't have the capacity to do that. And so vital information has gone.
Ariane.
Thanks, Convener. It's been a really interesting opening so far, and I've got a number of you have mentioned about the budget being too high a level to really understand usefully or to scrutinise it usefully, and and obviously we are here to scrutinise the Marine Directorate in a way. That's something that we've chosen to do as a committee, and I'm also hearing that there's a need to incentivise change and to achieve national outcomes that you mentioned, and also to so that we ensure that we reach the objectives of the Marine Act and the Fisheries Act. So maybe I could start with Phil, because you mentioned it first. How do you see public money being used to incentivise the change that we need and to achieve those outcomes? And then maybe I'll come to you, Colin.
Thank you. Yeah, I think one big issue here is the grants. You know, we've got this £14.5 million. Alan mentioned the Marine Fund Scotland money that's been issued in the past, and I think that there are some serious questions about how that has actually been used to incentivise change. So I just did a quick bit of maths last night, and I think it was something like between 11 and 12, 15 new bottom trawl nets were bought in 2024 for about £75,000 using public money at the time when we're talking about the need to better manage that fishery and the need to mitigate some of the impacts of that fishery in places. You know, a boat was bought, a new keel. Six and a half, nearly 70 grand's worth of money was spent changing the polarity on a winch on one of the biggest dredgers in Scotland. And I don't really see those tallying up with public priority, really. And I think that there is, therefore, a significant mismatch in the way that public money is being allocated in terms of incentivisation. And the committee is well aware of how incentivisation works in agriculture, far better than I am. And we're talking about, you know, slightly more than a tenth of the greening budget that's available for agriculture, available here. And that does lots on our land. Members are well aware of how much is going on through that budget. But we are not seeing a tenth of that kind of drive in the sea using that public money. Just to really drive the point home, one of those boats that was bought, a net, was impounded for, you know, the justification for that net was it reduced bycatch, helped resolve the discarding issue. One of those boats was impounded in Ireland for bycatching too much and discarding illegally. So that's public money that's then sort of led to not the public benefit, but in fact actually driven things the opposite direction. I think that that's a place that the committee should really pay some attention to, actually looking at how that money was spent in previous years, what those outcomes, the target outcomes were, and how those target outcomes were achieved. I think that's really important. Thank you for the question.
But Charles and then Alan.
Thank you. On this sort of question about driving change forward, I think an important priority that needs to be sort of emphasised is around the whole question of marine planning. It seems to me that underpins the collaboration and the cohesiveness of different sectors working together, and it's clearly problematic what's going on with marine planning. It's now 14 years since there was regional marine planning was first proposed under the 2010 Act. It's 9 years since the regions were defined, and we're still at the draft stage on one of those plans, certainly on the mainland. So I think that's a really important component of trying to drive change forwards. It's clearly not happening, and it a major priority must be for that going forwards.
Thank you. I've got Alan and then Aline.
I absolutely agree with what Charles just said there. I think it's kind of ludicrous that it's taken so long to move these things forward. As we said earlier on, there's a growing consensus that subsidies for polluting or damaging industries distort both economic and environmental returns. So if we're going to address the biodiversity crisis, we need to start to redirect public funding away from environmentally harmful activities and towards sustainable practices. And that's on land and sea. That's across the piece. As Professor Sir Dieter Helm has consistently pointed out, such benefits would be expected to lead to net economic gain as well as environmental benefits. So it seems to me that that's definitely the way that we need to move forward.
Elaine.
Thank you. Just in terms of the budget, I agree with everyone, it's quite difficult to tell from the space, but obviously the budget is different from the actual spend. So when we're looking at the actual spend in 2022 to 2023, the budget was 72,000, but just over that, but the actual spend was 80,000, just over 80 million, sorry, 72 million and 80 million. So and the same for compliance. So we've went from 26 million to just under 29 million for compliance. So the spend is actually more than the budget. And the areas where we're seeing increasing spend, a pattern of that is in compliance, marine planning and environmental monitoring. The areas where we're seeing a decrease in spend is science, sea fisheries and aquaculture. And actually we've had a kind of historic underspend in science. And I think I go back to Robin's point as well. I think innovation is important, but I think stability of science helps us to find out where we are in terms of the ecosystem. And I do worry a lot that we are, it's not always about money. It's sometimes about trust and the ability to work in partnership to find out what your ecosystem is, what your science is. What we're also seeing is a loss of boats. And that ability to work with government, I mean, I'm finding now that government are asking for meetings with fishermen and fishermen, or they're wanting to go out and observe trips, and it's very difficult to get boats that are actually out in the water to take them, because they're reducing too. And I think there must be a way that we have to collaborate together. It's not about money, it's about perspective in some cases.
Thank you. Elspeth.
Yeah, in terms of... you know, is public money being used to incentivise change? I think one area where many of us would feel that there's been a serious lack of investment of public money is around our inshore fisheries. We have many, many data gaps, quite poor information in many of our inshore fisheries compared to some of the other fisheries. We have now the government... have recently, fairly recently brought in interim management measures for inshore waters and have ongoing discussions with industry and other stakeholders about what these should be. But these are based on data that in some cases is at least 5 years old. So I think it comes back to Colin's point about without investing in the knowledge to actually understand the problems or the issues or the challenges that you're trying to manage, then it's very difficult to match the management interventions to the actual reality on the ground. So I think that's an area where there's definitely room for improvement. I also think too that there could be much better collaboration and working between industry and the government. There's a number of areas in which we collaborate. But I think there's industry certainly ambitious and interested and keen in many cases to do more. But there always seemed, or there often seemed to be hurdles and barriers that make that harder rather than easier to do. And I think we would like to see the government being a bit more open-minded, a bit more ambitious perhaps about how it can sort of engage in those sorts of collaborations.
I'll bring in very briefly before going back to Ariane, Michael.
Just very quickly, it's people that affect change, and I don't think we're investing enough in people. With the focus on inshore fisheries, which is going to increase very much so in the near future, although the government has invested in the initiative of inshore fishery groups, so IFGs, they're not resourced adequately. And to be quite frank with you, they're scaled at the wrong scale. I think if we were to actually bring ownership and responsibility back to community-based management, we can see from many other examples around the world and also within the UK, the Isle of Man, for example, that these have actually led to positive biodiversity outcomes and more profitable fisheries and better well-being for the people that are involved in them. We're just not putting in place the right mechanisms and structures to actually support that.
Thank you. Ariane.
Thanks very much for all of your responses. So I just wanted to clarify then, should we as a committee be asking the government to publish a more detailed level so we can really actually see where the money, where the budgets are intended? And should we be asking for the government to be reporting on what was spent and how it was spent? For example, in 2022, we approved 25,000 for the Marine Directorate for additional duties from leaving the EU. And should that kind of thing cover reporting? It's kind of like a yes-no answer in a way.
Elspeth.
I think one of the challenges I had with looking at this budget data, which is very high level, was also, was this just budget allocation or was it how it was actually spent? What was the budget outturn? Because what's allocated at the start of the year is not necessarily where money ends up going. So it was very hard actually to even understand, was this what was spent or what was actually allocated? So, yeah, there's
so a better transparent, yeah. I mean, yeah, because as a committee, if you're saying it's difficult and we're a committee and we need to be scrutinising it, then it needs to be a much more accessible form and give us that level of detail.
Yep. I've got Alistair, Elaine and Colin.
My point's very quick. I think it's a matter of trust between the Marine Directorate and its key stakeholders about publishing financial information. The RIFG network are probably one of the closest stakeholders to the Marine Directorate. And I have previously in the last year been told I'm not allowed to find out about RIFG budgets. We are recipients of money as we claim it, but we don't have management control or any decision-making powers. So it's a transparency, it's a governance thing that the government needs the confidence to publish to its stakeholders financial information. I know it won't be abused.
Elaine.
Yeah, I would agree, but I also think there needs to be some regional analysis. So before this committee, I actually did manage to get the budget headings, the spend and the actual budget. So that's why I can say with confidence compliance has went up, marine planning has went up, environmental monitoring has went up, science, sea, fisheries and aquaculture have went down, and we have had an underspend. But I think there has to be regional analysis of those resources as well. I know certainly in the Clyde, we're one of the most controversial areas. We have a few boats left, but we have a very heavy compliance programme in our members' opinion. And I think we have to be looking at about why are we doing this? Are we doing it because it's reactionary? Are we doing it because it's proportionate? I think this internal analysis has to happen. And I also think there has to be some kind of awareness of the amount of money that is out there and isn't being connected properly. So, for instance, what is Nature Scot doing with science and what is Marine Directive doing with science and how are they different? Because obviously Nature Scot is awarding various grants to various bodies to do work. Often fishermen never know about that. And we have reached out to Nature Scot, so it would be good to have a better collaboration with them because I think we could be duplicating work or there might be better ways to do it. I have to agree with Michael. I think that we have to get back to some kind of regional management and we have to get good people that have trust and understand what's going on with the budgets regionally because I would be very concerned that there's a lot more on compliance than there is on actual science. I think we need to readdress that.
Thanks. Thank you. Colin.
I think that there's a challenge in terms of the question we're asking. We're asking about resource, but I think the first thing that we have to establish is what does Scotland want in its marine environment, in terms of its state, in terms of the biodiversity, in terms of what it's going to get from it. And unfortunately, we have got visions and documents coming out our ears, but none of them actually seem to be delivering anything or resulting in any real change. So what do we want? Once we've decided what we want, what is it that the Marine Directorate is going to do in its contribution to delivering that? Because the Marine Directorate cannot do everything. And so we've got to look at it, what can the Marine Directorate do? What is its uniqueness? What can it do? What can it deliver that universities can't, that other places can't? The third point is that As we move forward, we are about to put the biggest footprint industry into our seas in terms of renewable energy. And how has this been funded? How has the research been funded? It's been funded by the Crown Estate. It's been funded by DEFRA. There is some funding coming from Scottish Government. But the key thing is it's multiple organisations funding it. And perhaps Scottish Government needs to look at that components and the money that's coming in from Crown Estate Scotland, can we make use of some of that money to actually fund the research? Because there's the potential that putting this industry into the North Sea will change the ecology of the North Sea, and that will have an impact on fisheries. It will have an impact on everything that we do. So it's about deciding what we want, and then who's going to do it, and then what is the Marine Directorate's contribution and making sure it delivers on it. Because one thing I noticed in the Spice report is that we've had no report on science output from the Marine Directorate since 2018.
Thank you. I'm aware there's others want to come in, but I'm going to keep things moving, just looking at the time, and I'm sure you'll have the chance to put your points on record when we explore some of the other themes. So we're going to go on to look at marine science specifically. Rachel Hamilton.
Well, I mean, there's so many incredible academic voices here in the room today, but I presume that the long-term respect of scientists on an international basis from Scotland, if it's not being resourced properly, will be to the detriment of our international reputation. And, I mean, we visited the Marine Directorate on Monday, and we did, to be fair, have a fantastic visit. We could see what they were doing with the resources that they had, and they were a very jolly bunch, but it was specific work that they were doing, and some of it was industry-led. So what I would like to know is, how is our international reputation being seen at the moment with the reduction in the output of scientific papers? And do you think that the way the government internally are seeing things is that there will be an industry sector sort of match-funded approach with the Scottish Government if the budget is being squeezed? I might go to Michael next door to me.
Well, of course, at the moment, the UK fishing industry does contribute insofar as it pays a levy on landings of fish, and that funds Seafish, which is a partner organisation which has been mentioned before, which we can use effectively. And I think it's worth scrutinising that relationship. We need all our bodies which are funded to be pulling together. I'm not saying that they're not, but we need that to be coordinated and for roles and responsibilities to be clear so that we have additive benefit, we're not conflicting with each other as well. So I think that is a positive. Basically, there is a mechanism there to actually raise money in that sort of industry, you know, pays or contributes to the science. I totally agree. But Colin really put his finger on it. The big money is actually going to come from the Crown Estate. And the Crown Estate is a key player here. We've seen previously the Crown Estate through the Cowrie Fund when wind renewables were originally came to the table in the early 2000s, actually put together a central pot of funds which was used strategically to the benefit of all. So it wasn't specific to a particular business or wind farm development. The science all had to be generic and therefore benefited everybody. And I think a similar sort of model would be extremely beneficial in this particular circumstance.
Okay.
Anyone else
Robin,
want to?
Do you have...
Were you asking specifically about international reputation?
Yes. The number of, obviously, peer-reviewed scientific papers that have been produced, is that having a detrimental impact on our reputation in Scotland?
Yes. It's difficult. You know, there is hard evidence about the number of publications, and inevitably people see that and respond accordingly. But it's quite difficult to produce hard evidence that the reputation has suffered, other than through anecdotal discussions with other people. And I'll give you an anecdote. I was at a, you know, ICES is the body that does most of the international assessments of fisheries. And every now and then they do a benchmark assessment of certain fisheries in different areas. And they had one in 2020 to look at the west of Scotland stocks. And there were two principal stocks that were being considered, West of Scotland cod and the West of Scotland whiting. And the Marine Scotland science people were there to represent them. They have most of the data, most of the survey information and so on and so forth. The whiting assessor, lead assessor, proved unable to do the assessment. And as a result, the Danish Institute picked up that and did the assessment for Scotland. And it seems to me that that's a very serious problem where you have run down the expertise to such an extent that not only are you now reliant on institutes in other countries to do the assessments for you, but the ability of the Institute to advise its own division and minister is compromised. And you know, you find it in other ways where these multi-institute partnered research programs that people bid for money for, they don't go to the Marine Lab any longer because it's not worth their while. And so I think it's an extremely serious problem. I really do. I can't see how the existing infrastructure, like how that capacity is sustainable itself in the long run.
I've got Elspeth, and I'm going to bring back Michael.
Robin's anecdote's very powerful, actually. I mean, that's humiliating. I wasn't aware of that. I'll give you another concrete example. So I'm co-director of a Centre for Doctoral Training, which is funded at a UK level. Heriot Watt University is the only Scottish university involved in that. Part of the success of actually winning that funding, which basically funds 48 PhDs across the UHD, focused on the sustainable management of marine resources, so the next generation that Robin's talking about that we need, Marine Scotland Science promised to co-fund 20 of those PhDs. A year after we were funded, they withdrew entirely. So there's a reputational issue. I mean, Robin's touched on it, but you don't get much more reputationally damaging than saying you're going to commit to co-funding, and we're talking a trivial sum of money, actually. It really was. I mean, we're talking tens of thousands, not hundreds of thousands. That is very reputationally damaging. People, once they're burnt, don't come back for a second time.
Elspeth.
Thank you. Yes, we also hear these anecdotes about feeling that Scotland has lost its place on the international stage. I think there's an element of both being unable or unwilling to engage in those sorts of international projects, but also just lack of physical visibility. I think people no longer travelling to meetings, not being seen internationally so much. So that sort of drives that whole perspective. Robin mentioned the West of Scotland COD and Whiting benchmarks. We had a not dissimilar situation earlier this year with the Monkfish benchmark, where there was good engagement and good input from the marine lab scientists in really driving good outcomes from that benchmark, but also industry put a great deal of effort and resource and scientific analytical input into that exercise. And I think, again, what Robin said about the Danes undertaking the Whiting assessment chimes again with what I said earlier about the fact that our mackerel stock assessment now is led by the Danes, who actually have a very, very small stake in the fishery compared to Scotland, who have a huge stake in it. Also, just touching on the point that Mike made about money that will come from the offshore renewables industry. This is an industry that, as Colin Moffat said, is going to have an enormous industrial footprint, essentially, in our seas, and is likely to have an impact on the environment, on fisheries, on seabirds, on cetaceans, on physical ocean processes, many of which we have a very poor understanding of what the impacts are going to be. Now, between the ScotWind leasing round and the INTOG leasing round, the Scottish Government, through the money that came to Crown Estate, the revenues that will flow from those two leasing rounds, I think, is in the region of about £1 billion. And we heard yesterday that some of that money is being used to obviously address other black holes in the wider budget. But really, when we think about the challenges that we're facing, that we're speaking about here today in terms of lack of resource in understanding our marine environment and having the necessary resources that we need for our marine policy and regulation, one would think that the revenues that will flow not just from these option fees but in the longer term from the seabed leases surely needs to be something that the Marine Directorate is able to have access to. The ScotMER programme, which is their marine environmental research in relation to renewable energy, is woefully underfunded and is not moving at anything like the pace that is necessary to understand the impacts of offshore renewable energy before the developments will be built.
Thank you. Alan and then Elaine.
I would agree with those comments about Scotmer. There's an evidence map that's been set out for diadromous fish with a whole series of evidence gaps, but it's not apparent how any of those evidence gaps are going to be filled. But I wanted to mention the sort of freshwater side of the Marine Directorate, because as it stands at the moment, there's actually some really fantastic work going on, which is of international renown. I'll give you a couple of examples. I mentioned the last time I was in front of the committee, the National Electrofishing Programme for Scotland, which not only gives us really good, a really good understanding of what the juvenile densities of salmon and trout are within our rivers, but we also collect water samples, so we get good understanding of water quality at those sites, and also genetic samples, so we understand genetic integration from fish farming through that programme. But as it stands, there's not sufficient resources to conduct the sampling and the analysis of that work on an annual basis, which is a real disappointment. It's a really good example of work that's coordinated and funded centrally, but delivered locally as well. Another example is the Scotland River Temperature Monitoring Network, which has given us fantastic information about the potential for our rivers to heat and become essentially inhospitable to salmon. So that allows us to direct resources to where we need to plant trees to shade rivers and take the appropriate care. So there is some really good work going on. Lots of other countries are looking at us in those areas, but it's a resourcing issue to make sure it gets taken forward consistently, because you need those long-term data sets.
Elaine, Colin, and then Charles.
Yeah, I just want to highlight, I completely agree with Elspeth's point about inshore science, and it's been a massive problem for us. And I'll give you two examples. Obviously, three examples. We had the cod box, which I feel we started three-year trials with Marine Scotland and with St Andrews University, which were going very well. They were stopped. They were at a minimal cost. But when they were stopped, we had a whole ideological debate about what should happen with an area. And I would have personally preferred to work down that line of collaboration and continued that. We obviously had the crab and lobster issue, which has happened lately around the coast. We are using seven-year-old data as a minimum. And some people are still, it's always, there is a trial on that. But there are other areas that still feel that seven-year-old data is not appropriate to be using when it means that they may be looking at losing their livelihoods. We also have a lack of data on the pelagic. You talked about that. We haven't had our surveys on herring, and likewise, the Irish are offering to do things. We've offered and fully costed up. It would be very minimal, but we can't take it forward. So we're in a situation where you really don't know what's happening. But what we're finding is that we're even as a fishing association spending our resources fighting political decisions instead of working with people on science. And I think that's something that we need to turn around. And it's not just about science stocks. It's about things like we could be applying Anchor Lab so that we're able to fish, but also protect the features that are out there as well. These are fairly simple things that we could engage in for science. And I think we'd really have to get down to that. And just on, I think Elspeth had just mentioned Scotmer. What we're hearing a lot of is modelling systems and precautionary approaches. Precautionary approaches can have a massive effect on communities as well. We have to be aware of that in science. And the modelling systems are only ever going to be as good as your sample data that you put in. And if your sample data being put in is just based on a compliance trips or observer data, very, very limited, you're not going to get an accurate result as well. So it has its place, but you can't replace actual science. Thanks.
Thank you. Colin, I think, and then Charles.
Thank you. I think there are still some shining lights in the Marine Directorate, and one area where our reputation is still very strong is in the area of organic contaminants in marine systems. And indeed, the Marine Directorate led for the Northeast Atlantic on the recent assessment that came out in 2023 on organic contaminants. The two issues that I think have to be urgently addressed is, first of all, the Marine Laboratory has lost its ability to actually do the analysis for Scotland in terms of actually looking at the contaminants because of the lack of investment in the analytical laboratories, which have now been moved to the University of Aberdeen but are not yet functional and have not been functional for some time. But the other thing is the two scientists who have been instrumental for the last 15 years in delivering this are, like me, ageing, and they will retire. And I'm not aware that there's a good succession plan in place to make sure that we maintain our credibility in that area. So if we are again come down to being dependent on single individuals. When they go, then the concern I'm hearing is we've got no staff coming in behind us to do that.
Yeah, there's obviously been a lot of consensus, I think, around the difficulty or the lack of resource directed towards gathering data, and that clearly is an issue. I think another thing that needs to be sort of brought out of this is that there is also a problem around the amount of resource that is being dedicated towards the analysis of the data. And I think that's a sort of a distinct issue, and I think it's an important one. And certainly I think that's been an issue around some of the crab and lobster work, is that there is more recent available data, but it hasn't yet been analysed. So I think that's a separate but important component. And then I think there is a third issue around this whole question about science, which is whether all the data, whether it be analysed or not, is actually being utilised. And I think that's been an issue that we've certainly seen in the context of the Clyde Cod, for example, where we know of certain reports which weren't necessarily being taken into account. So I think there are three components there that I think are each of importance.
Elspeth and then Michael.
Yeah, I think perhaps just a couple of practical examples that I think touch on the points that Colin and Charles have both made about that expertise, planning on both having people and facilities for the future and actually being able to analyse and interpret samples that have perhaps been collected. We have a situation currently where I think, you know, we see in many of our fish stocks, it's not always just about counting fish and where they are, but actually being able to really understand how there might be mixing between different substocks. And this is something that is going to become an issue that we're going to have to grapple with in terms of the management of the Northern Shelf cod stock. And this will be, whether it will be an issue for next year or a year into the future, I don't know. But it's going to be something that we are going to have to get to grips with. We are also aware that our pelagic self-sampling scheme has identified some herring that don't look like the herring that we would usually see in our North Sea fishery. So this looks interesting. Is this something about mixing between the Norway stock and what we would have in the North Sea? And samples have been collected by industry, sent to the marine laboratory, but they don't seem to have either any ability or great ambition to do any analysis of them. They haven't got the necessary equipment to do the modern type of genetic testing, yet this is going to be the sort of technique, the sorts of tools that we're going to need for the future for better management. So industry is keen to do this, collect the samples, send them in, they sit on a shelf, and actually they're going to be sent to Norway and they'll do the analysis for us.
Okay, Michael, then Robin.
So we've heard that we need more resource on analysis, and I would agree. But to have analysis, you have to have highly qualified and motivated people who are interacting with other scientists so that they're aware of the latest techniques. I actually think this committee should think about the culture within Marine Scotland science as it exists today. We aren't seeing the scientists out and about on the international field. Their reputation is withering. For the last 2 years, I've run a fisheries conservation conference, open to everybody, no cost at all, at Heriot Watt University, invited Marine Science Scotland down. And the response I got said, I need to seek permission to come to Edinburgh to attend a one-day conference. And permission was withheld. Now, that seems to me like a micromanaging culture. Scientists are like plants. They need light. They need water. You put them in a dark room, they're going to wither and die. So I would take a close look at the culture of the organisation. Nothing is going to change if the culture is wrong, and you'll never hire highly qualified people to do your data analysis because it's an unattractive employer.
Robin.
Yeah, just to go back to this question of reputation, we've talked about the capacity and so on and international visibility, which are all clearly important. But there's a more insidious problem, I think, which kind of undermines the credibility of Marine Scotland science or Marine Directorate science, which is the position which science sits in relation to government. If you look at the European laboratories across Europe and indeed in North America and in the United States, the science is managed at arm's length from government. And as a result, the perception from other scientists is that here is a more independent organisation. And so there's a lack of trust, actually, between people outside government and government science, because there's a fear that it's been manipulated or influenced unduly. And one gets a strong flavour of that, actually, in the discussions around the issues in the Clyde. And something which happened, I believe, more recently, when Marine Scotland was set up, in other words, when it transitioned from agency to what was Marine Scotland, we put in place a science advisory panel to ensure the objectivity and the neutrality of the science. That's been done away with the creation of or the transition now to Marine Directorate. And again, that undermines the perception that what is the science coming out of Marine Scotland is actually neutral, objective science. It looks as though it's too influenced by government.
Thank you. I'm glad you answered that before I asked the question. It's better coming from you than necessarily come from the convener. So thank you. Elspeth?
No.
Okay, we'll move on to a question from Emma Harper.
Thanks, convener. Good morning to everybody. I think actually my question has been answered because I'm trying to get my head around this as pre-budget scrutiny, and we're talking about resourcing for science and data analysis. So everybody's been quite clear about that. And looking at, there seems to be ways of supporting the Marine Directorate to get funding. And Alan, you mentioned tree planting next to rivers. So that would be a Forestry Scotland budget, I'm assuming. So it seems like there's a lot of cross-portfolio potential, but the collaboration that Elaine spoke about is something I would be interested in exploring. How do we support better collaboration so that access to funding can help support data analysis and then obviously the interpretation of that? So I'm not sure if that will be a question maybe for Elaine to start, and then Elspeth I see indicating just about how do we support better collaboration. But I'm thinking about that in terms of finding pots of money to support the Marine Directorate.
Yeah, I mean, I think that you're probably very correct in terms of what you were saying about the neutral body and about the trust. And we had always supported Marine Scotland Science, Marine Science as being a more neutral approach. So we'd like to see that. But I do think you're right about these discussions between Nature Scot and the budget lines and the science that's happening there and the science that's happening within fisheries. Because I don't think there's a lot of discussion. And I think there is, and I may as well just say it, I think there's a perception that there's alignments of certain parties with certain groups. And so potentially we don't have very good relationships with some groups, and we need to try and break that down. You know, there shouldn't ever be a worry about going to speak with local fishermen. That's something we need to address, because it's almost, if you speak to most fishermen, they'll feel as if they've been slightly vilified in terms of being part, you know, that is how strong it is. So I think that's kind of borne out in the budget when you look at what's happening with the compliance going up and the lack of science, etc. And I think if we can find a way just to get that dialogue going and take some of the politics out of it and get back to the baseline science. But I do think there has to be a discussion between Nature Scot and between Marine Directorate. And also I want to say there's a lot of really good people in Marine Directorate. It sounds like we're attacking continually. I don't want to do that. But I feel that they are so constrained. And I go back to that point about the 7.5 years full-time post in 18 months in FOIs. That is really significant, because how do you build good relationships with people when you've got that culture where there's a constant asking, constant question? We've had quite a few judicial reviews. There's an edginess. People are frightened to work together because they feel that this may be an issue, or they may be questioned on it, or there may be... And we have to say that out loud, because it's preventing good work going forward, and it's preventing breaking down those partnerships and working together. Thanks.
Okay. Just on the back of that, that would suggest there's just a complete lack of sufficient transparency in some of the policy decisions that the Marine Directorate are putting to the Scottish Government, because we've seen, and it was touched on, the lobster and crab, where we had a policy being brought in, it was challenged by fishermen, and there was a bit of political pressure. That's resulted in a one-year trial. And the fishermen are absolutely biting the hand off Marine Directorate to get the equipment to provide evidence on what their argument is. And this is seen as a fantastic evidence of a good relationship between fishermen and the Marine Directorate. But that only happened as a result of a lack of transparency, a lack of proper engagement with the fishing industry in the first instance. So it's all about transparency. This is for the
I think so, and I think there's a culture of reactivity as well. Because I think it goes back to what Robin's saying about having stable science. It's not always about innovation, it's about stable science. And if we had that, I think quite often we go off in key areas, Clyde being one of them. We've got a big sea. We're a key point of interest continually. I think if we had stable science, it would take a lot of that reactionary work. Because I feel for Marine Directorate, because sometimes they're pushed down corners. And I think this culture of kind of campaign-led work instead of actually let's get the data. Thanks.
Alistair.
Seeing lines joining up here, somebody down here spoke about Marine Directorate staff not being able to travel. Now we're talking about the crab and lobster interim measures. I had 4 meetings in my area with crab and lobster fishermen prior to these measures coming in. They were about engaging with them, they were about asking them what was acceptable, what was not, because I was part of the influencing of what these measures would be. For all these 4 meetings, Marine Directorate staff said they couldn't travel, and they weren't, well, in many cases in the North West Highlands, they couldn't link in online. So they were just seen as government afar, and they were issuing decisions which they hadn't directly heard from the people who were affected by them.
Okay, thank you. Elspeth.
Yeah, thanks, convener. Just again, maybe an example of where there has been some good collaboration, but there's scope for more, and perhaps some of these issues that we've been discussing about of culture are perhaps getting in the way of that. So the Scottish Pelagic Fishermen's Association, which is one of the constituent members of SFF, runs a pelagic self-sampling scheme. And what this means is that the industry collects the samples that are needed to feed into the international data framework for stock assessment, and the analysis is carried out by the Marine Laboratory. And the industry was able to drive that forward through being involved in an EU-funded project. I think it was called the Pandora Project. And it wasn't necessarily easy to get this to the stage that it's at now, but it has worked well and it is working well. But the industry is quite keen to do more. So at the moment it's focused on fish sampling, but there's a real opportunity, again, through collaboration, through EU-funded projects, which the UK still is able to access, to add in, for example, environmental sampling, which would add data, would add information, would in time add knowledge. But there doesn't seem to be sort of ambition or enthusiasm, perhaps, in the Marine Directorate to engage with that. Now, again, I don't want to be
a lack of trust.
Well, I don't know if it's that. I think, you know, Elaine made an important point. This is not about being critical of individuals, but I think it comes back to Mike's point about culture and the ambition to actually become involved, the ambition and perhaps the ability. What are the barriers within the current structure that are actually preventing the scientists from engaging in those sorts of quite big international collaborations where there's real benefit that could be brought for Scotland from those?
I suppose what we're touching on is, so up to now the Marine Directorate have often used their own ships and boats to collect information, but it doesn't seem like rocket science to suggest a way to maybe improve that coverage and reduce cost is for the industry to provide those samples. And we did see, when we were in the labs on Monday, scallop shells being collected. It was industry that was providing those scallop shells for ageing the scallops rather than Marine Directorate scientists going out and collecting themselves. And it was a win-win. So what do you think those barriers are then? Just to say, industry, we want you to provide these samples.
Well, certainly you have to
be able to ensure that whatever is done is scientifically robust. That's important. But I think some of the things that we've run into are, you know, sort of procedural things, procedural barriers. So industry for the last few years has carried out some of the monkfish surveys that are necessary to generate the data for the stock assessment because the lab can't carry them all out themselves. It went better this year, but last year they almost didn't happen because of problems getting through the sort of hurdles of procurement. So again, there's procedural barriers that actually prevent rather than enable better collaboration and better use of wider resources.
Okay, thanks. I've got Emma would like to ask a supplementary. Maybe come back to you.
I'm actually okay. Yeah, thanks.
I'll bring in Emma or supplementary, but I know there's one or two stakeholders that want to still contribute, but maybe add to the responses, Emma.
Yeah, I'd just be keen to know from everyone if there are specific avenues for either revenue raising or the Marine Directorate doing what it already does, but using less money to do so that jumps out at anybody in particular.
I'll go to Phil first, Michael, and then Alan.
Thanks very much. I was going to put a supplementary, but I'll jump across that. I think there's actually several no-cost, no-regret options available right now. So we've talked about money from leasing seabed. So that's a public asset, right? Seabed is a public asset owned by the Queen, etc. The other one is the fish. The sea, the fish in them, public assets. That's established in law. It's not controversial. Quota is the way in which access to some of that is distributed. Not all species, some species. And there's a kind of artificial categorization of quota at the moment going around. I won't go into why it's artificial, but there's something called additional quota, which is the post-Brexit bonus quota, if you want, like that language. And this is quota, therefore, that was never allocated to a business. So it's not tied to somebody. Someone's not built a business plan around it, business expectations around it. And it is up to the government to distribute that. Now, it must distribute it on the basis of Section 25 of the UK Act, which says that it must be distributed based on environmental, social and economic criteria. So a balance, again, those points that I'm making. It's not just me saying, let's do the only do the environmental side of things, and be used to incentivise selectivity, so catching less by catch, and forms of fishing which have a reduced impact on the marine environment. That's all in law. Now, at the moment, it's distributed using something called quota management rules. Those quota management rules don't really regard environment. They certainly don't talk about enhancing selectivity. They certainly don't talk about incentivising actions which have a reduced impact on the marine environment. So what's happening at the moment is that additional quota is getting put like a cherry on top of the cake for those who already have slices. There is a real opportunity there. Like I said, no cost, no regret, opportunity to use that to start to drive change, right? So if we're saying, oh, well, we're going to have to moderate this behaviour or adopt this slightly different approach, there is an asset there. It is in public ownership, which has no sort of issues around its being used. In fact, its current use is, in my view, unlawful, counter to Section 25, and is one of the legislative failures that I referred to earlier, and that can be used to start distributing in ways which then promote the activities which cause less bycatch, or promote the activities which reduce harm on the seabed, and do that in ways which create a race to the top. You're giving something to people who are doing best, and you are not actually having to take away anything from those who are performing least well. You're actually, in the first instance, certainly, just in creating an incentive mechanism. And keep coming back to it. Agriculture, we've shown how powerful incentive mechanisms can be to actually creating that change. And the fishing industry, as you all know, is extremely innovative and will very quickly start to address some of these issues. And it's all tied together. The supplementary I was going to mention, if I may just very quickly, was that I think that your question, Mrs. Harper, was about crossover between different departments, different sections of government. I think that there's also problems within crossover within Marine Directorate itself, where you are having, for example, quota issued in a way is not then incentivising that change. Meanwhile, there's a group of people trying to figure out how they reduce bycatch. and that link-up is not happening, and there are these no-cost, no-regret options on the table to do it. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Michael.
Yes, I was going to attempt to try and answer Emma Harper's question, actually, because I don't think anybody has, but Phil just touched on it very briefly. It's a very challenging question. I think one of the key problems, and Robin touched on this before, is the fact that Marine Scotland has come into the Directorate, so it's now locked to government, so it's actually, you've cut off its freedom to seek additional income, which was the other supplementary question that was asked. But in terms of within different government agencies, a lot of different departments are creating a lot of work for Marine Scotland Science, particularly in the compliance team. And so that is taking resource from the focus on other areas, and we've heard it's taking it away from science and research, very little research done. Now, with our investment in offshore renewable energy, if you think about going back to your question, it would be good to do an analysis. What are the key points in the process where you could actually lever money out of the system at that point? So at the moment, there's a kind of a community fund which the renewable energy sector has to contribute. Well, maybe we should be talking about a marine science strategic fund, which then becomes a pot of money that can be used to do the research that they're not able to do at the moment, which is then going to underpin the advice that that then informs the compliance teams. Because at the moment, we've heard over and over again that they're using out-of-date data and relying on work that other people do, whereas actually a lot of this needs innovative work. So it's not just at that point. You rightly raised the issue about planting trees. I mean, I don't know what the departments called these days, what used to be bays in the old days at a UK level, is obviously generating lots of business development. But then again, quite rightly, should there be funds drawn down to actually support the Marine Directorate? So I think the Marine Directorate is being sucked dry by other policy-driven areas within government without realising it. But the key thing is, if you keep it within government, it's on a permanently declining budget. Public resources are not getting any bigger. So it comes back to this point that Robin raised, that without the freedom for the organisation to seek additional lines of funding, as, for example, CFAS have done, where they're providing scientific advice to the Falklands government, to Kuwait, to the Saudi government, and drawing in income which then supports and subsidises the work they do for the UK taxpayer, we're never going to get to a point where Marine Scotland can be strategic in the way it thinks about how it develops science and invests in people going forward in the future. And I think so there's two lines there that we need to look at. The structure of the entity, external outside the UK potentially, but also how we allocate money within government. I hope that answers your question to some extent.
I've got Alan, Elspeth, Elaine, Charles, and then Emma with a supplementary. Alan.
Try to be quick. I just wanted to reflect on some of the discussion around compliance. And I'm not really specifically talking about Marine Scotland compliance here. I'm talking about compliance across the board in Scotland. We're in the middle of a biodiversity crisis, and a strong view of our members is that compliance isn't sufficiently robust across a whole series of areas. So I just wanted to give you one example. And it goes back to that resourcing within the Marine Directorate again as well. So fish poaching for salmon and sea trout is the highest volume wildlife crime in Scotland. But through our network of water bailiffs and through close working with Police Scotland and Crown Office Procurator Fiscal Service, we also have the highest rate of conviction of any class of wildlife crime. But we also have the lowest fines. On average, it's under £250, which just simply doesn't act as a disincentive for that sort of behaviour. And this is an endangered species now we're talking about with salmon. So we've tabled proposals for changes to the offences in the legislation and the associated fines, but that require resources within Marine Directorate to deliver. So it's not necessarily about budgets, it's about priorities and prioritising that sort of work going forward. With regard to where money might come from, the committee might want to consider whether Marine Directorate are using their charging schemes to the extent that they could do. That's another potential avenue for funding that's being used in other areas.
Okay, I'm going to bring in Elspeth, Elaine and Charles, but just we will be moving on to compliance and enforcement and collaboration and co-management and further themes, but bring in Elspeth.
Yeah, thank you. I think another area where Marine Directorate could have a sort of clearer strategy that might be beneficial is around their use of scientific quota. So Scotland will have 2% of scientific quota above its national quota that can be used for scientific purposes or monetised to be used for science. And I don't think we've got a proper strategy around how that scientific quota is used or could be used going forward. It is something that we've certainly raised with the Cabinet Secretary, and she's certainly willing to have further discussions about that. But I think that's an area that is worthy of further exploration.
Thank you. Elaine.
It's a really simple question. I think we should be looking at reference fleets. We should be looking at local boats and just working with them to try and collect as much data as possible. I think I said that in my response, that even things like temperature sensors and boats could be feeding through. That helps to address what's happening with stocks and with climate in regional areas. That's a simple, easy win. Those kind of things we can be doing. But you know, I'm really struck by the fact that Michael had mentioned a profitable fishery in Isle of Man because of regional management. That's something we kind of need too. We need to have something that's sustainable in all senses. We need a sustainable fleet. If we have a robust fleet, like they do in Norway, where they pay 3% of a levy and that helps towards the science, I think most of our fishermen were always of the mind that that would be something they'd be willing to do if it meant that they had science that meant that they weren't closed down and it allowed them to kind of direct what kind of fishing opportunities there were. What I would say is it's difficult now because we don't have a robust or profitable fishing fleet in many of our areas at the moment. And we have to acknowledge, I certainly acknowledge in the 10 years that I've been in this job, that that's not the situation we really have in our region anymore. So I think being aware that we need to protect our features, but we need to protect those communities and the funding that's in that business and develop it in a sustainable way to have good science.
Thanks. Charles.
Thank you. Your question on revenue raising, and Elaine just touched on it in a sense, but I mean, that's an issue that certainly my organisation has looked at, and in particular around the question of extending the landings levy. Obviously, it's been, as Mike Kaiser mentioned earlier, it's something that funds sea fish. In our opinion, it acts as an effective mechanism for essentially a resource rent. It's not without its problems. It needs to be defined, but in terms of what happens about bycatch, which is essentially an extraction of some of the resource which might not be included within a levy, but the broad principle of raising the landings levy seems to us to be a sensible way to go forwards to raise money, particularly for fisheries science, but it could apply across the board to other aspects of Marine Directorate's activity. It's a well-established principle, obviously, with regards to the sea fish already, but also in other sectors in Scotland. You see it in aggregates, you see it with water abstraction, even petroleum revenue tax are all levies which are imposed sort of specifically on an industry over and above the general taxation. And it seems to be wholly appropriate for a public asset, which is the fishery resource.
Thank you. Colin.
Thank you. I think that in terms of resource, one of the things we have to be conscious of is how we might fund a policy department and how we might fund a science department are actually quite different. The policy department is working for today. The science department, to some extent, is working for tomorrow. And Robin raised the point of the Science Advisory Board. And in addition to the Science Advisory Board, there used to be two executives sat on the Marine Scotland Board. And what this does is it brings to the director of Marine Scotland the view of some external people. And it's not just the scientists saying we need more, and this is what we need to be doing, but it's some external people as well. Scientists respond very well to peer review. That's what we're trained to do. And so if you have a science advisory board coming in and working with the scientists and together putting the case for certain funding to the body that's going to be providing the money, then you have got some opportunity to get that funding. But under the current model, I think we will continue to see the attrition because, as a number of people have articulated, you cannot get the resource in for tomorrow because everybody, you know, basically the money's been looked at for today, and that's not how you can fund science.
Okay, thank you. Now, at this point, I think it's probably a good time to have a short comfort break. We'll take a 10-minute break. Thank you. OK, we'll now resume our session with our marine stakeholders. And we're going to move on to our third theme, which is compliance and enforcement. And questions from Beatrice Wishart.
And can I just say it's been a really interesting round table so far. I'm looking forward to hearing the rest of the views on the issues that are of such importance to all of us, given that we live in this island community. Compliance and enforcement accounts for the largest proportional share of the Marine Directorate budget, and we had figures from Elaine earlier on, an average of 37% from 2009-10 to 2022-23. During the committee's pre-budget scrutiny in October 2022, the Cabinet Secretary, in responding to a question, said if I had an unlimited budget, it would be great to invest more money in more vessels for enforcement. So my question is, I'd like to hear the views regarding the Marine Directorate's compliance and enforcement capabilities, but my question is whether the current approach to compliance and enforcement is cost-effective. I don't know who might want to kick off with that.
He's not catching my eye. What, Alistair?
Once again, I'm going to apologise because I've got very recent experience only to rely on, but I used to run the Isle of Man's compliance facility. And I'm going to pick up on the last bit. It doesn't appear to be cost-effective to me because of very local delivery of compliance. There's a lack of consistency in the layout of fisheries offices. Example I gave Phil just over coffee there was the air office covers from Helensburgh to the border. Yet within the North West, I've got four offices. The government should be harnessing some of the savings from the technology that's becoming available to them. The workload should be decreasing because we've now got automated Fish One forms going in, and that's taking administrative burden off of the service. And when we look at enforcement capability, we now have much enhanced capability to remotely see what's happening at sea from either aeroplanes or from drones without putting expensive ships out.
Phil, and then Elaine.
Thank you. Yeah. I'd support the point made by Alistair there that electrification, digitisation of this enforcement and compliance capacity could offer significant better value for money. I think that the numbers that we're looking at in terms of compliance are very, very large. So I think that the aircraft budget, the aircraft contract was reissued at, I think, 1.7 million for a year. So that's for the use of two aircraft. And of course, running the boats is very expensive too, as well as the fisheries offices, which Alistair referred to. Some manifestation of all of those assets is needed, and I actually have had fairly positive interaction with the compliance teams when I've been a witness in cases of illegal fishing. But I think that as the committee took evidence on the remote electronic monitoring previously, I've got the numbers here, between the first and the sixth year, an REM system would cost between 10 and 27,000. And we're talking about, you know, in terms of the trawl fleets that would potentially use this system, some hundreds, not loads of boats. And then after then, between 2 and 11,000 per boat. So a fairly cost, you know, the cost of that in sum is very significantly less than having to chase every boat or be witness every boat using boats and aircraft and other mechanisms. Of course, some iteration of those assets is still needed just to make sure that you're checking up on boats that have switched off or things like that. And sadly, we've had some reports of boats with the REM system on the dredge fleet doing just that, using sort of loopholes. That's unsubstantiated right this second. The other opportunity that provides is to address the science issue, which we spoke about earlier. So, in fact, Marine Scotland's leading fisheries scientist wrote a paper, I think it was 2014-15, setting out how a remote electronic monitoring system could provide not only compliance benefits, but also the data needed by the fisheries managers to better manage the stocks. That's Marine Scotland Science, a peer-reviewed paper. It's sadly following the pattern that Charles spoke about, where the science isn't then really being enacted or followed through into policy. It could address some of the issues that Ms. Harper mentioned as well, about bringing those two budget lines across, right? So we're looking at actually resolving the science issues, like addressing some of these gaps in the science budget here, using assets, resources that are being allocated through the compliance budget. And I think that that has to be the way forward, right? You order a pizza right now, you can track on your phone the journey of the pizza from dough to your door, right? And yet we don't know where a very significant proportion of our fishery is actually operating. That's their under 12 metre boats at this moment. And we don't know with any kind of resolution what's being caught and where to inform those in the detail of actual volumes of catch, because there's significant bycatch that's needed to inform those management decisions.
Aline and then Elspeth.
Thank you very much. I'll just give a quick example. One of my members phoned me yesterday to tell me that he just spent £3,000 on fixing part of his VMS system. He has another two parts. He's not too sure if it's going to cost that for each of them. So just so that we do know, fishermen have invested quite heavily. The ones who have VMS, etc., have invested quite heavily. You have to actually take out annual subscriptions, etc., as well. So the cost of compliance for them is quite onerous too. So I know they're talking about the margins in fishing isn't what it used to be, and I think we just have to acknowledge that as well. In terms of the compliance, yes, it is a large part of the budget. I think we had a good meeting with the compliance team and the Clyde not so long ago, but that was after Operation Galeen was published and we didn't know that was happening. So just to say how it feels on the ground, I think a lot of fishermen are very aware that there's quite a lot of calls in about potential activity, and so that can spark a boat coming out, etc. And you can feel a little bit like you're being followed. And we've brought this up before in various forums. I think we need to understand, this is why I think regional analysis is important, because if we need to be sure that we're doing proportionate compliance around all of the areas and making sure that we're hitting those kind of risk areas and not potentially just responding to continual calls, that might be happening in regional areas, we don't know because we don't have that data, but I'd like to see that spend. The other thing I was going to say was in Anchor Lab, I keep bringing this up. Anchor Lab is a really important tool. We trialled it first in the Clyde and also the Western Isles, which will allow you to... It's a sensor system. It's also depth sensor system. It can show that you're not fishing on features, that kind of thing. It's also good for compliance. So these kind of things are quite innovative. Of course, the costs, but I mean, with compliance, I think they're talking about fleet replacement now, and a lot of the systems that are being used are quite old. So I think we have to acknowledge that. But yeah, I do feel it has to be regionally assessed, and it has to be proportionate to the fishery that's happening there, and we need to have that breakdown to see what we're spending. Thanks.
Elspeth.
Thank you, Convener. I think the question asked was, is the current approach cost effective? And I don't feel I could answer that question, because I don't think we've got the information to be able to answer that question. So I think it probably comes back to the points we've already discussed about just how much information is available about what the budget is spent on, and sort of drilling below the high-level figures. So I think it maybe touches on the next theme that we're going to speak about too.
Michael and then Colin.
I think it would be very helpful if people sort of in the area of compliance and enforcement actually looked a little further outside the box. So with fisheries, we have to remember that when you sell fish landings, they go to a processor. So processors actually act as a central point where all this product is coming in. The much more sophisticated processing facilities that we have these days, typically sort of a barcoding product, so you know which vessel that bag of fish or scallops or whatever it might be has come from. And actually, the compliance and enforcement teams, by working with the processors, could actually intercept product in a much more efficient and timely way. And I think what we've not done in this whole space is have a discussion with the processing industry. And the processing industries that I talk to, who are engaged in responsible activities and sustainable activities, are more than happy to sort of work with that. And of course, once you're in a factory, you've got the opportunity for AI. The other aspect of compliance and enforcement is you actually want to reduce the number of illegal acts that actually occur. Unfortunately, in the UK at the moment, our current system of fines are woefully inadequate. When I was working in Wales, we had illegal fishing activity in Cardigan Bay. One vessel made £450,000 and was fined a maximum limit of £50,000. That is just an overhead. It's just a green light to go and indulge in illegal activity. So I think there's another fundamental issue that needs to be looked at. Number one, should these criminal acts, well, they're not criminal acts, they're actually civil offences, should they actually become criminal acts, we should really be looking at the fine. You know, it should be in proportion to the actual offence that's actually been undertaken. And if we could remove those bad actors, which at the end of the day, like any industry, are the minority, then, you know, the reputation of the industry and the sustainability of the industry would greatly improve.
Thank you. Colin.
Thank you, Convener. One of the problems with the lack of granularity on the costs is that certainly, if my recollection is right, the compliance budget used to also cover the science ships. And so there are two science ships. So there are five ships running, of which two are science. So it may well be not the case anymore. Certainly, I think it was the case that a proportion of the compliance budget should actually be nominally over to science because compliance was running both Alpenamara and Scotia.
Yeah, that's an interesting point. Phil.
Thank you for coming back in on this. Just two very quick points. So, again, looking at the numbers, last year there were 16 cases went to the Crown Office for prosecution, 13 of which, by my calculation, would have been identifiable using remote electronic monitoring. So in terms of cost benefit, I think that there would have been a very significant cost benefit against that. And then just to elaborate on Mike's point about better sentencing, which is also a point that Alan made earlier. Of course, one thing to do there is to change the legislation to increase the what is defined as the maximum penalty in the legislation. That's difficult for this committee. It's got plenty of other work. But one thing I would like to suggest that this committee could do that could practically address this issue very quickly would be write to the sentencing councils. So there's a sentencing council about environmental law and environmental crimes. It is, as everyone, completely stretched. So its remit is not really heavily focused on this at this point. If this committee were so minded that this were an issue that deserved further attention, the committee could indeed write to that sentencing council and recommend they look at this with some priority. Not recommending specific actions, perhaps, but just recommend they look at it. And that, I think, would move things forward on that, and it would be very welcome. Thank you.
Michael.
Thank you. So taking it back to a point that we discussed earlier, actually, if we move to a system where we had more community-based management, there would, by definition, be some ownership rights associated with that. In other words, that local communities that were involved in that fishery model would have ownership of the resource, not the seabed, but the actual resource. And that would actually completely transform the nature of a crime, because people that are fishing illegally are actually stealing from the people that locally depend on that. And that suddenly then becomes theft. So it's not just about adjusting legislation and fines, but it's also about creating the right systems where those sort of laws and legislation can actually be applied as well.
Is that maybe a role for the regional inshore fisheries groups, though? I know they're undertaking a review in the future. And we have a different model of these groups south of the border that are well funded, and it's a completely different picture up here. Do you see a role for Regional Inshore Fisheries Group to do some of that work or collaboration?
Absolutely. I mean, they would be the right model. They're maybe not structured correctly. They're probably maybe a bit too big, so the geographic scale of them may not be right. But, I mean, that's not for a discussion here. That's for a discussion outside, out of here, what the right sort of scale of those would be. But, yes, that would be the role. It would be local management informed by science, but also informed by the stakeholders involved in the actual system.
Yeah. Alistair.
As a chair of a regional inshore fisheries group, there's a strong demand for more control local at a more local level, whatever that is. And I hear what Michael says about boundaries. We've got plenty of boundaries in the sea already. We can choose which ones we want to use. But it would get that community buy-in. It would increase compliance because what is happening would be known, as opposed to the remote service that we've got at the moment.
Beatrice, and then I'm going to move on to Rhoda.
Yeah, one of the things we heard about during the discussion about REM, remote electronic monitoring, was about how the Marine Directorate would ensure compliance by non-Scottish vessels. And it was highlighted there was approximately 150 non-UK fishing pelagic species in Scottish waters throughout the year. So I wonder if anybody has a comment on that.
Phil.
So if you're referring to non-UK vessels, it's of course perfectly within the Scottish Government's, Scottish Minister's powers to license that activity in whichever way they feel is appropriate. So they could easily put on any boat coming from international waters into Scotland to fish the same duty, the same REM duty. If you're talking about UK, other bits of the UK, so boats that are flagged to England that are coming into Scottish waters, it's just a process internally within the governments that there's a request given. So I think my view is that it's not a massive barrier. I think it's just an administrative one.
Okay, thank you. Elspeth.
Yeah, thank you. And of course, the REM legal requirements will indeed apply to those pelagic vessels that are non-UK flagged operating in Scottish waters. I think something I hear anecdotally is that in the current model, whereby compliance and enforcement is more about physical inspections, boarding of vessels, etc., certainly I hear from associations that our members feel that there's more focus on the indigenous Scottish fleet than on other fleets that fish in our waters. But with the information that we have available about activities, I don't know that it's easy to really ascertain what the actual case is. I think, touching again on REM, and it circles back a little bit to some of the things we spoke about earlier, and this committee has heard a lot about REM over the last while. And again, my understanding is that Marine Directorate were involved in some earlier EU-funded projects in terms of, you know, how REM can be used with artificial intelligence and, again, investment in other ways of carrying out functions, but that their involvement in the next phase of this project has not continued. So, again, they're being left behind in that development in terms of how you can actually use technology to do things differently. So, again, perhaps comes back to this earlier points we spoke about engaging in international projects and sort of looking beyond the immediate horizons.
Okay, thank you. Rhoda.
Just very much on the same theme, I think local management would give local fishers ownership of their own area and create better compliance. But how do you, and I'm not trying to pitch one sector against another, how do you then involve those fishers that are not boats, that are not locally based in that, so that if there's local compliance set up in a local community, there's a lot of the fishing community that kind of move quite a lot that are not locally based. How do they have a voice, and how then is compliance encouraged? Sorry, I'm not putting that very clearly.
This may be one for Alistair and then Michael.
I'm not checked the current legislation on that, but I'm aware that if I go and drive my car in France, I've got to drive it on the far side of the road. You comply with the local rules when you go somewhere, and whether that is legislated for or not, I'm not absolutely sure at the moment. But make it incumbent on visiting vessels to comply with local with our rules here would be necessary, because otherwise you'd have a sloping pitch where they either got an advantage or a disadvantage.
I guess what I'm asking, is there an easy way of doing that? Just understanding how do you make those rules available so that people coming into the area very quickly get them and comply with them?
Yeah, so speaking from experience south of the border, So south of the border, you've got the IFCAs, the Inshore Fisheries Conservation Associations. They have jurisdiction out to 6 nautical miles. So most of what we're talking about probably would be in what we would define as inshore waters, I suspect. You're going to need different management systems for offshore waters where the fleets are much more nomadic and the species are more nomadic. So IFCAs have bylaw making powers. So your IFGs, for example, could have bylaw making powers. And then, of course, you know, those are consulted on and they're made publicly available. But they're a bit more fleet of foot because they are bylaws, so they don't require formal sort of all the formal processes of formalised legislation. So they can be made very quickly. And of course, what you do in your community-based system is vessels from outside that traditionally have fished in that system can be part of that system. There may be a membership fee, for example, which then helps to underpin the funding and the running of that IFG or whatever it would be. And they can buy into that and they would be part of that consultative process. I mean, if we actually look at the Shetland Fishery Management Order, that works very effectively. Admittedly, very few, if any, outside vessels involved in that. But that is a model which functions with lots of different sectors, but working in collaboration with each other. And the key thing the fishermen in Shetland say about that system is because the communication is good and everybody understands what is going on and everybody has a voice. Or they may not get their sort of their way, but their voice has been heard. And it's about, again, it comes down to culture and structures and bringing it down to a more regional level, I think, is much more appropriate and effective.
Alistair, do you want to come back in on that?
No.
Elaine?
We do have things like voluntary closures that we've been able to push through the IFGs. For instance, they may impact some nomadic Isle of Man fishermen who will be alerted to that by the fisheries officer. They usually will just send them out saying that this is a temporary closure or whatever. We haven't really had many issues of that being broken. However, some fishermen in some instances would like to see things that are not just voluntary, particularly when it comes to things like pot limits, etc., for regional areas, but obviously displacement is an issue too, so that's for consideration. Thanks.
Phil and then Alan.
Thanks very much. Just the community-based decision-making framework that's available, I think, at the moment is the regional marine planning one, which the committee's considered in the past, right? There is this duty in the 2010 Act to develop regional marine plans, and that gives a very significant opportunity for local community to have a say, including fishing community. There is in the budget here, in the budget spend from last year, I think £12 million spent on planning in Scottish Government's budget, £1 million a month. I'm not clear that that's progressed marine planning very far. The regional plan that is that would be developed using that would dictate how any licensed fishing activity took place within it. That's established based on our judicial review. And so I think that there is a very strong power then to use the mechanisms that this committee has already asked the government to prioritise to actually deliver what Mrs. Grant's proposal recommendation was there for this sort of localised decision-making that then establishes a rule that anybody coming into that area must comply with. Because just as Alistair said, anyone coming in has a licence. It's not a free activity. You are licensed to undertake commercial fishing, and the licence will dictate that when you are there, you must comply with that regional marine plan. Yeah, thank you.
Hey, Alan.
I can absolutely see how a community-based model would be a really good way of managing a shared resource. So the sort of examples that have come up in the discussion today, I can absolutely see that. But I'm less clear, and there's a degree of ignorance on my part here, as to how well those models will work for protecting marine features or protecting non-target species and things like that. So you mentioned IFCAs earlier on, and I'm aware of some work that's been done in the south of England with acoustic tracking of salmon and sea trout, which has demonstrated quite significant bycatch within some of the gillnet fisheries in the south of England, which, because salmon and sea trout aren't really considered a marine species, certainly south of the border, the IFCAs don't appear to be particularly well placed to actually address that issue. As I say, I'm not hugely close to that issue, so I'm talking from a degree of ignorance there, but
it doesn't strike me that they're necessarily always well placed to deal with the wide range of issues that need to be addressed.
Thank you. Elspeth.
Yeah, I think just a point on IFCAS, because I think there's been quite a lot of conversation about how that's a different model to what we have here with the regional IFGs. But certainly speaking to colleagues south of the border, I think I don't think we should leave today with the notion that they're a perfect solution. I think they're a very mixed bag. I think there's some good IFCAS and there's some bad IFCAS, and some work much better than others. So I don't think it's just a switch one thing off and another thing on. It's more nuanced than that.
Thank you. Alistair.
Over the last year, it's crept into government documents that regional management of fisheries is coming on the horizon, and the RFGs are being quoted as the most appropriate bodies to pursue that. And yet, we need to have a more open discussion, a wider discussion than we're having this morning, because I know myself and my colleagues are not clear about what that means. In terms of, are we following the IFCA model? Are we expected to revise our own model? But while it appears in a number of plans now, and a number of statements have been made, we need to bring it into the light and examine the models that we can use and which one would work best for Scotland. Because I'm not sure that just assuming quite an expensive model at the IFCAs is either affordable or appropriate.
Elaine and then Michael.
Pick up on Nick's point there, Phil's point there. The regional marine planning he'd mentioned would be, I think we have to be, this is a concern of mine because we're touching a lot on fisheries management through marine planning, which I don't think is a specific function. IFGs to filter up into marine plans, and I would say that's how I see that working. And I think when you're talking about Shetland, you talked about how it works really well there. They've got a regulating order that was run by the fishermen. We had an attempted regulating order which was imposed on us, and so the balance of who's round whatever table is going to be really important. The fishermen have to have a say in that, and I would say the IFG and local fishing, of course, have other voices, but I wouldn't see regional marine planning as being the ones who decide on the fisheries licence solely by themselves. Thanks.
Thank you. Michael.
It comes back to structures and culture. I'm certainly not advocating an IFCA model. And if we look around Scotland, Scotland regionally is hugely diverse. So inevitably, if you were to go for a community-based management system in each part of Scotland's coast, it would look different because the fisheries are different. The actors involved are different, and different areas will have different problems. Some will have problems with sea trout, for example. But as soon as you move to a model whereby people are truly involved in co-management and they feel they're in control of their destiny, they're much more likely to address and focus on solving a problem, like a marine feature that needs protection or a particular species where we've got a bycatch issue, because they're in control of their future and there's benefit to them actually in investing in that. Co-management systems exist around the world. They existed and they run very effectively. Which model is the right one? We're not going to decide that here. But there are plenty of models and they work, and people would find the right way in the end.
Just finally, in this section of compliance and enforcement, does there need to be a cost-benefit analysis done to look at the whether it's effective, whether it delivers what it says in the tin, because there's very little point police in trying to enforce a 30-mile-an-hour limit in some parts of Dumfries and Galloway where there's no cars on, and there's no benefit to it because there's no evidence of accidents or whatever. So that's maybe an analogy. If there is to be a cost-benefit analysis, who should carry that out? I'll ask you, Michael.
Well, I would have it carried out by an independent body external to government with suitable scrutiny and with probably a panel of experts as well in putting into that, preferably from outside the UK to make it completely clean and without any potential for bias.
Thank you. Robin.
Yeah, just on the point of who should do it, it was done some years ago by Professor John Beddington, who was the then chief scientific advisor to the government. So it was done at a very senior level, and I guess a similar model would probably be satisfactory. But just on the cost-benefit analysis, one sort of smaller point, a high proportion of the cost of compliance is running the vessels. And they're currently run in-house. Now, when FRS, as was, became Marine Directorate, the vessels had been operated by a commercial company. So it was the operation of the vessels was outsourced. And at the time of the creation of Marine Directorate, the research vessels were incorporated into the protection fleet, essentially. And the cost of running the vessels increased. So something which you could consider, and of course it's a politically sensitive issue, is whether you would get more out of the research vessels, the protection vessels, if the operations, in other words, running the vessels, not the policing itself, but the operation of the vessels was actually outsourced to a commercial company.
Okay, thank you. Phil?
Just to add to what Dr. Cook said, I think that there was a more recent one done. Certainly we were promised there was going to be one in 2018-19, I think, in-house. I really endorse Professor Kaiser's idea of an external consultant from outside the UK. Sounds a very good one.
Okay, thank you. We're going to move on now to our fourth theme, which is collaboration and co-management, and a question from Elena.
I've tried to reformulate my questions in my head as we've been going through, because I think a lot of them have actually been answered, as is always the case in such roundtable discussions, because there's such rich, in-depth discussion going around the table. It's absolutely right that we should be looking at this in the space of collaboration and co-management. Indeed, the joint fisheries statement itself says our future vision is that the industry should take a greater shared responsibility for sustainably managing fisheries while making a greater contribution towards the cost, including such things as work to develop new management practices and contributing to fisheries science, being more actively engaged in fisheries management decisions and co-designing future policy. And we've just heard as well about joint endeavour. So if we get to the space where we are, you know, doing with and not doing to, we actually take all of the communities with us. So in that vein, you know, we've just been discussing the FMAC, we've been discussing the regional groups, we've been discussing the regional marine planning partnerships, etc. So I had questions around about their effectiveness, whether this is the right model that we should be using. I think we've already kind of strayed into answering some of those questions. But I'm just really looking for, you know, if anybody wants to put a little bit more meat on the bones of that, not looking to see what a future model could be, but right now, are we actually realising the intention that was set out when these types of local partnerships were set out to feed into the wider system? And what could change now and rapidly whilst we're actually looking forward? So I don't know who wants to start me off. I was thinking maybe Elaine in terms of from the Clyde Fisher's views, but also Alistair, because you sit on one of those groups, you're in charge of leading that, etc., and then open up wider.
The Clyde has been a pilot for a lot of things. It's been a pilot for marine planning, etc. We don't have a plan yet, but I've been a member since about 2017 of the board. I think we need to have clarity in why we're all around the table, because I never go to a regional marine planning meeting thinking that I want to double the fleet. That's not what I do. That's not why we're there. We're there to think about how we can cooperate and collaborate. But I think other people have to understand that too, that we're not there just to push our own objectives. It's not a lobbying body. And we have to find a way to make the best and most responsible decisions. And for that, we need clarity. And we're talking about fisheries management and how that relates to marine planning. I think that's a bit jumbled. And we really have to get that tight so that everybody's around that table understanding why we're there. That's one of the key things. The IFGs, do I think they work? I think they have worked quite well in the recent past. I think more resource, and I think it's been a lot to do with COVID. I think a lot of people not meeting in person. But there's also a trust issue, because I think if they feel that there's not been an ability to change policy decisions at a higher level or to influence their local management, then that stops people engaging. And so we have to kind of build that back up again. And there has been a capacity issue too. We've got a lot coming at us from renewables, from aquaculture, from various things. So I think we have to understand there's a capacity in the fishing sector. My association's almost halved in 7 years. And I think this is happening all around the coast. So we've got more to deal with, less capacity, so I think, and less trust. So I think if we can get that trust and we don't feel that things are happening to us all the time, you might get fishermen back. But fishermen have been a little bit reluctant in the last while to engage because they'll say things like, our ideas are never taken forward anyway for conservation, etc. And that's really disheartening. And at times I can't convince them that it's worthwhile them being there. So I think we need to kind of address that. The IFMAC, I think that's important. And I think that's certainly an area where everybody can have a voice. But I do think fishermen have to have a voice too. And that's where I think the IFG is. But the IFMAC is obviously wider stakeholders now. That is under review. But no, I think we need more structure, we need more guidance, and people have to be honest about why they're attending things and understand the remit and not push for agendas and actually do the best for the remit that we're there for.
Rachel's got a little question on your contribution.
To whom does the group report and how often?
When?
Well, the inshore fisheries groups, or
the inshore fisheries group, yeah. Certainly. I mean, we've got different regional areas, but our southwest one met last in November 2023, and previously we would have met kind of quarterly at least, or maybe have some sub-regional groups. So I think COVID did impact that, and I think it would be good to get back into structure where we're meeting more often and we're having everybody around the table.
Just these groups, who do they report to?
They report to Marine Scotland. Well, Marine Directorate, sorry. Yeah.
Maybe I'll ask Alistair to come in at this point, because he'll probably be able to answer your question. So we've got Alistair, Charles and Elspeth.
The RIFGs are funded by the Marine Directorate. It is in our contracts that we're independent. How independent we can be might be limited by the fact that we're funded by the Marine Directorate. We're very closely engaged with fishermen. We've just done our first six-month report for this year, to January to June this year. Of the six regional groups there are, we've held 20 formal meetings with groups of fishermen. Many of these are not big meetings. The average attendance is about 10. But we're engaging with the fleet on a very regular basis, and we've actually recorded something like 250 meetings on pierheads, just grabbing fishermen as they come ashore and listening to their views. I'd like to, while if you tolerate me, while we're on the subject of collaboration and co-management, I think everybody around this table largely accepts that co-management of the fishery is the future. But there is a significant minority of the fleet who don't. They are a minority, but they are fishermen who want to fish. They don't want to manage. They're not there to write the rules, they're there to fish. That's how they make money. And they don't make money in meetings like this. So we've got to engage with them as well, because many of them are not represented here. They're not members of associations. They're very independent people. And that is the difficult constituency that we're trying to access. And it's not a sexy job. Standing on the shores of Loch Duart waiting for one guy with a creel boat to come in so you can talk to him because he's not spoken to anybody for about 6 months. It's not easy. But we've got to be aware that not everybody is wholeheartedly going down the route of collaborating and co-managing, and a lot see the risks of poachers being gamekeepers.
Okay, thanks for that. That's helpful. I've got Charles and then Nailsmith.
Thank you. excuse me. To your question around sort of how the current mechanisms of co-management are functioning. I think the sort of ostensibly the structures are quite sensible. So, I mean, RIFGs clearly is made up of the fishing industry itself. It doesn't have wider stakeholders in it, and that's an important thing to bear in mind. The FMAC groups and the subgroups are obviously a much more multi-stakeholder entity. From my own experience sitting on one of the subgroups, on the climate change one, there are significant problems associated with actually it functioning. We've had one meeting to date about a year ago. To be fair, there were no outcomes coming out of it. I'm not blaming the individuals involved from Marine Directorate at all. I think and it's been clear from anecdotally from a lot of conversations we've had that this has been the lack of progress comes down to resources. I mean, that gets mentioned quite often as the sort of opening gambit in these sorts of conversations. So I think there are problems.
associated with the functioning of the excuse me, of the current setup, and I don't think it's exclusively to the that specific FMAC subgroup. I think there's other issues around some of the other ones as well, where there are problems associated with quite the direction and the speed at which things are moving forwards. I know that's been an issue around some of the way that business has been taken forward around fishery management plans, for example. So there are problems, and I think, you know, in terms of budget scrutiny, I think a lot of that does come down to resource. But it is perhaps also worth asking whether it's wholly about resource. And I think this is a key point, is that there may also be some strategic decisions being taken as well as to what is the most effective mechanism within the FMACs to go forwards.
Okay, thanks. Okay, Elspeth and then Michael.
Yeah, I think there's a number of different ways, I suppose, to look at this. I think I hope I've given some examples this morning about actually how we've got some fairly good collaboration on the scientific front. I think we would like more, and we've been engaging with Marine Directorate some ideas that we've had, not just recently, but over a number of years, around how we could perhaps sort of improve that collaboration and build on it. I've spoken about the pelagic self-sampling scheme. We've also got the SFF observer scheme that we run, because Marine Directorate currently can't, and we deliver all the data for that. So I think there's collaboration probably on the scientific front. I think in the policy space, it's a sort of different discussion, and that's a piece around co-management. We have lots of words, but I don't think that it really feels like co-management to many folk. There's a review underway at the moment of the FMAC model. That's the Fisheries Management Conservation Group. And as Charles alluded to, there's a number of subgroups that sit underneath that, I think some of which work probably a bit better than others. Some meet more frequently than others. But I think certainly our view is that that FMAC model does not work particularly well in terms of co-management. And I think that's particularly become the case since it was, I suppose, reinvigorated a bit after COVID. It went into a bit of a sort of vacuum during the COVID times. But I think it's also important that we remember that there's certain functions that the Marine Directorate must discharge. There's certain functions that they have that others don't. And I think we have to be we have to be mindful of that and thinking about co-management and actually where responsibilities for carrying out particular functions actually sit. So it does feel that it's a bit of a mixed bag at the moment. As I say, I think there's some good collaboration in some areas. We would certainly be keen for more. We think there's scope for more, ambition for more. But I think the co-management piece does need to be rethought quite significantly.
Thank you. Michael.
Yeah, I'll try and be brief. So absolutely right to mention before that you've got different groups of stakeholders, some who are very engaged, some who are not at all engaged. To move forward into what you have at the moment is a basis for developing co-management, but I wouldn't actually say it's co-management. It's basically people who have vested interest for the right reasons sitting together in the room, but they're not actually empowered to do very much, really, to be quite frank, and they're not resourced to be able to them to innovate and, you know, solve problems together very effectively. But there's a basis there for taking that forward. The other thing to appreciate is it takes time. When I was providing science advice to the Isle of Man government, we moved into a co-management system. It took 5 years before the fishermen then actually saw what the benefit was. Huge amount of resistance. They were dragged into it, kicking and screaming by their producer organisation, and it relied on that person showing real leadership. 5 years later, the fishermen could all see the benefit. They were all financially profiting from it, and the marine environment was profiting as well as a result of that. So it's a long-term investment. The other key thing which nobody has actually mentioned here is we need to invest in our fishing industry. And when I say invest in them, I don't mean build new boats. We need to actually get them involved in education programs. So I'm a trustee of Fishing Into the Future. We'll be working with Elaine's members shortly. There's a huge amount of misunderstanding. When I say educate, I don't mean that in a patronising way. It's about misunderstanding. Misunderstanding are the same English words we use. Sustainable means one thing to a fisherman, as compared to what as a scientist, how I would translate that. And so investing in those people so that they are empowered to engage in co-management, because at the moment they're not, because we tend to use language that they do not understand, is an essential part of this process, which we have neglected thus far. Were you to go to America, the US, you would see a very, very educated fishing industry, fully engaged in fisheries management. They're not afraid of the terminology because they've all been, it's actually mandatory for them to attend training courses now because the US government feels it's so essential that fishermen understand what the process that they are part of.
Thank you. Colin.
Thank you very much. I think one of the other challenges we've got is it's not just about managing fisheries, it's about managing all the other human impacts that are involved in changing our marine environment. And around Scotland, of course, we have our aquaculture industry, which is a very significant industry. We're about to put a massive renewables industry into our sea. We've also got the tourism and the changing climate. And one of my concerns is that Scotland's Marine Assessment 2020 was put in place to provide the evidence for the National Marine Plan revision. And here we are in 2024, and yes, there has been some developments in terms of consultation, but we are well down the road from the 2015 implementation of National Marine Plan 1, and we have got massive change. You know, in that time, the atmospheric carbon dioxide has gone up significantly, and that means there are other impacts on our seas. And so I do think that we have to seriously look at how are we going to look at not just the fisheries aspects, but all the aspects, because none of them are independent of each other. They're all going to be intertwined. And we've spoken about ecosystem assessments and reports for long enough. We still don't do it. We still tend to be very sectoral in how we manage things. And so I think there does have to be a regime shift in how the science is obtained and then how it's used, and collaboration amongst all the industries that are involved in exploitation of the seas is absolutely essential, including tourism, which has an impact as well.
Alina.
Just to briefly come back and following up on Professor Kaiser's point regarding a really engaged and knowledgeable fisheries sector in the States, I want to come back to Elaine and just touch a little bit about a really engaged association that you have, your membership. We're driving a huge amount of gathering data for a long time, and we're actually actively looking at how do we manage the stocks within and the cloud of cod. I'm wondering at this point in time, how do we use the structures that we've got in terms of the groups that are set up to re-engage with those fishers who could potentially be the ones that help us to look at collecting temperatures and collecting data and feeding into that science, because it's very easy to become disengaged and to become one of those individuals that Alistair was talking about who is no longer interested or who has never been interested in this. How do we actually address that?
I'm finding, because as I said, we've always had a very active fishing association, and it saddens me to see fishermen now just going, well, it won't make a difference what we say. However, I do think there are ways to do that. I mean, I think if we start to maybe include them in the reference fleet work, I think that's really important, because if they start to practically see the benefits, like you said, it takes a while to see the benefits, but if they feel that they're playing an active part, then that's important. We're also training a lot of new starts to come up into the industry because we have a huge issue with depopulation. Maybe starting with them and letting them know a little bit about fisheries management and about how that happened. I know that quite a lot of the young guys that we trained up were very active in the highly marine predator area debate, and it was lovely to see that. But I have a fear that we're talking about a sector that doesn't really exist for me anymore. Because if you're talking about how well we engage, if you came to me 8 years ago, it would have been great. But I'm very aware I've got 30 boats, or just over 30 boats, or just between 35 boats now, compared to 65. And that definitely makes it more challenging. So I think capacity in the fishing industry, we need to appreciate that that's quite tight. And so it has to be worth their while, and they have to feel that they're going to make a positive change and not feel that things are just done to them.
Elspeth.
Yeah, I think just worth thinking about a couple of things pertinent to this. I think one of the, I mentioned earlier that there's ambition within the pelagic self-sampling scheme to extend that beyond sampling fish to actually taking environmental samples and environmental monitoring. But there doesn't appear to be a lot of enthusiasm to engage with that at the Marine Directorate, and that may well be because of stretched resources. But I think also we have to think about what are perhaps some of the barriers that exist to how we can sort of harness and use a lot of the knowledge and information that fishermen have, because they spend much more time at sea than anybody else. And we know that, for example, the ICES model isn't built to sort of incorporate that type of anecdotal information, that sort of information coming from stakeholders rather than from the national governments who are part of the ICES machinery. So I think that is something that ICES recognises possibly a missed opportunity, and something that they are beginning to think about how you could do that in a way that was formalised and structured. But I don't think it's fair to think that, you know, fishermen aren't interested or aren't don't want to do more or aren't knowledgeable, because many of them are all of these things. They are knowledgeable. They do want to do more. They're really interested in what happens to samples that they take or projects that they're involved with. But we need to, I think, have better mechanisms for how we can actually make these things work better.
Okay, thank you. Ariane.
Yeah, just briefly, and kind of inspired, Elspeth, by what you've just been saying. Last summer, I met with fishermen, and one of the things that they said is they would love to be around the table with politicians and scientists. And actually, during the break, Colin and I were just chatting a bit about somehow there's information not quite getting through around scientists they look at this and they gather this data in this way, and fishermen are out on their boats and they see something different. And how do we join that dot and get together around the urgency of things that need to be changed? So we've got these forums, the RFGs, the FMAC, and so on and so forth, but somehow something's missing. And that might come back to, I can't remember who it was, I think it was Alistair, you were saying not everybody wants to get round the table. So you've got a problem there, because some people just want to go out and fish. But it seems to me that we've got all of these different fora, but something's not quite working. You're nodding. You want to
go to Elspeth and then Robin.
Yes, I think we have a lot of fora. And as I say, I think there's different reasons for why there are barriers and difficulties in some cases. I think resources is something in terms of, you know, what industry might have great ideas about, or other stakeholders have ideas about, might not be within the realms of what the government is able to engage with. There's the issue of things like the barriers that we have within ICES in terms of actually how do you capture that information, how do you formalise it, how do you ensure its robustness, how do you deal with what might be more sort of observational data than data that's been collected through scientific programmes. So, but I think too there are issues of, you know, there probably are issues of sort of engagement fatigue if people are engaging with things and, as Elaine's alluded to, not perhaps seeing change happening. And I think we also can't avoid the fact that, you know, there was a loss of trust over the way in which the highly protected marine areas policy went. That was difficult, and we've had to work quite hard to make sure that industry, you know, remains engaged and doesn't sort of walk away from the table on other conversations around conservation. So I think there's a lot of moving parts, and I think it probably comes back to what I said at the very outset. The Marine Directorate are spinning an awful lot of plates. And industry bodies like ours are also having to try and stay on those spinning plates and keep up with them all. And everybody spreads pretty thinly, and it maybe does bring us back round to thinking about, you know, is there more to do around real sort of prioritisation? And I think Colin made a really important point. We spent a lot of today talking about fisheries, but there's a lot more to the Marine Directorate's responsibilities than fisheries.
Thank you. I've got Robin, Phil, and then Michael.
Yeah, just to pick up a point that Elspeth made about the IC system finding it difficult to incorporate industry perspectives, if you like. Of course, it's much more difficult in the context of shared stocks like North Sea cod, for example, where it's very international to get everybody's industry involved. But there is scope in Scotland to do that for certain stocks. I mean, cod in the Clyde, for example. Now, in America, they have a very different system because there are one country controlling the whole thing, where they make sure that the evidence on which the management is predicated is shared, so that instead of being presented with an assessment, the scientific evidence, and saying, we're going to do this, what do you think? They go in at a lower level where the industry itself is involved in preparing the evidence on which the management decisions are made. And as a result, you get much more buy-in to the whole process. And it does seem to me that, at least for certain stocks or certain fisheries within Scotland, there's scope to do that. That it doesn't have to be, you know, a marine directorate assessment which is presented to the industry. The industry can actually participate in the whole process.
Thank you. Sorry, I missed out Elaine. I'm going to bring Elaine in before Colin.
I'm going to wholly support what Robin said, and just to say in the cod box trials, I feel we were getting there, that fishermen were understanding randomisation of stations and scientists were understanding why fishermen go in a certain way, and we lost all of that. So I think you're right on the button. We would love to do more of that. In terms of perspectives as well, you talked about, and just to go back to Eleanor's question, I mean, how do we understand each other better? I feel that things are really important to fishermen. Like you'd mentioned, Alistair, making a living to feed your family and doing it sustainably, of course, but your community relies on that. And I recently had a conversation with somebody and said, I'd said I was really concerned about the boat numbers, and they said fishing will always bounce back. Well, won't always bounce back, because we've got lots and lots of harbours inshore around the country that are empty. Maidens being one of them, was one of our biggest fleets. There's no boats there. So I think the things that are really important to fishermen, they're feeling that socio-economic debate is not being heard. And just to go back to that, I heard a point as well. We talked about MPAs yesterday with Marine Scotland, Marine Directorate, and Duncan McInnes from the Western Isles explained that one of his biggest boats, the gentleman who ran that came from Poland because they felt it was a better place to do business in Scotland. They've now moved back to Poland after a massive investment in the community in the Western Isles because they felt it was no longer a good place to do business because of the uncertainty over some policy debates. And I think it's a lot about getting people around the table at the beginning and actually doing co-management and co-science, because that would take a lot of people's fear out, because people don't want to invest in an industry where they don't understand what's going to happen to them next.
OK, thank you. Colin, Michael and Phil.
Thank you very much, Convener. I think that the more information we can gather, the better, but I think that the challenge with it, and I would fully support fishermen gathering data, the compliance vessels gathering data, but the challenge is that it has to have significant coordination. A good example of sort of this is a continuous plankton recorder, which has been going since 1931, and basically they tow a machine behind ferries. Now, if we can get something that does similar for fishing vessels or any other vessels, then we can gather the data. But the key thing why the CPR has worked is because it's been well coordinated, the samples have been analysed, the information has gone back to the people who've been gathering it. And at the moment, I don't think there's anybody who could take that on. The Marine Directorate certainly couldn't. But the benefits of putting something like that in place could be significant.
Thank you. Michael.
Yes. Well, we could go on for a long time, but we can't. So I'm going to be very brief. I think that is possible now, Colin, with innovation and technologies. I mean, we can fit fishing equipment with environmental data sensors, which can transmit to the cloud when they come to the surface. The key thing here, though, is giving that data back, giving that value back to the fishing industry. What does that data do? Better improves inshore weather forecast models, for example, so it's going to improve safety, could actually have insurance premium implications. We've been talking to Lloyd's Register about that as a possibility, reducing your insurance premium if you're able to show that you don't go fishing in anything over Force 8, for example, so on and so forth. So the ways of doing this. The one point I wanted to leave the committee with, picking up on Ariane's point, is that this industry has been promised everything, and very often and most usually is given nothing. I remember convening with Seafish and Fishing Into the Future a meeting in November 2019, just before we went into COVID lockdown. We had 90 fishermen, not fishing representatives, 90 fishermen in London, together with about 90 scientists and policymakers. The unanimous view in the room was co-management was the way forward. I'd like to leave the committee with a recommendation. I would have a look at three model systems in the UK. Shetland, very good example of co-management. The Isle of Man Ramsey Bay system, excellent, functioning, highly profitable, very good for the environment. And also the inshore potting agreement in Devon, Start Bay, where they actually collaborate with the Belgian and the Dutch fishers and the French fishers in the mid-channel. There are three models which I think provide a UK basis of systems that actually work. Obviously, they've had hiccups along the way. I would endorse that the committee investigates that further. It's always useful to have a model to base something on.
Thank you. Thank you for that. Phil.
Thanks very much. I think one of the big challenges that co-management has faced throughout is that the objective is not agreed. And I think actually if we all sat down and agreed those objectives and stuck firm to them, then I think actually we can all be adult enough to debate things and make progress on achieving them. And that is something that I think the committee needs to scrutinise more. Post hoc, what is not delivered from what it was said to be delivered. So I'm looking here, for example, at the 2021 programme for government. We will deliver fisheries management measures for existing marine protected areas by March 2024. We could have all worked together in a co-management way to try and progress that. That's been missed, right? That's completely neglected, and we need to look at that. Take specific evidence measures to protect inshore seabed areas outside of MPAs. You know, these are defined. Colin mentioned this earlier on about actually establishing what it is that we want to achieve, but it's been established many times. So the future fisheries management process was something that took several years up until 2020 and set that out. And then in 2022, I think we had a 12-point action plan to deliver that. That is what we in co-management meetings ought to be talking about. Right? How do we as stakeholders help, you know, have our say about how this should be delivered? But those are the things that we deliver. The problem we face, and we've just faced it recently, is that the government at the beginning, Marine Directorate at the beginning of a year, set out that this is what we're going to do. And at the end of the year, don't want to do it anymore for various reasons. And they're not resource focused, as far as I can tell. I don't have the detail, but as far as I can tell, that is not the case. And that is leading to legislative failure, and it is leading to the problems which Elaine has illustrated, you know, which are alarming, that a fleet is reducing that far. That is illustrative of the fact that these commitments which are made are failing to be delivered upon. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. We're fast approaching the end. We've got about... I'd like to think we can maybe tie up in the next 5-10 minutes. We've got one last theme. Most of the things we've covered already, but Colin's got a question on budget information and scrutiny.
Thank you, Peter. One thing that struck me looking at the responses to the evidence gathering was a comment about lack of information on organisational structure of the Marine Directorate, including which officials have responsibility for what. Now, that immediately, in terms of budgets, rings a bell about accountability, about the formation of budgets, about the execution of budgets, and about the scrutiny of budgets. And I realise this is the Marine Directorate, but I'd be interested in hearing from those around the table as to their feeling on the validity of this and how it impacts, whether there's any stakeholder input at all into these budgets, because if the statement is true, then it's going to be quite difficult for the budget to be formed with the stakeholders. Phil, maybe I can ask you to comment first.
Yeah. I don't entirely know the structure of Marine Directorate, and I don't from the organograms that were shared there. There seems to be some cross departmental things. So we've got sea fisheries over one side and we've got sea fisheries in science on another. I think that there is a significant opportunity to be improving the way that the silos in Marine Directorate are working. The place where that's been most stark historically, in my opinion, has been planning and fisheries management, where the Act, the 2010 Marine Act, is very clear, in my opinion, that fisheries should form part of the marine planning regime. That will help address the fact that there's going to be a significant amount of offshore wind built in the sea, and that needs to account for the fishing, the historic fishing activity in those areas. But I can't comment right now as to whether that is being addressed. I think that some of what we've heard today, Professor Kaiser spoke about a culture of scientists in particular feeling isolated. I think that that points, at least to me, to some serious management issues which relate to that, that ability to work outside of silos and the ability to work cross-departmental.
Perhaps key to this is knowing who's responsible for what, which this statement implies doesn't happen. Colin, can maybe ask if you can comment.
I think that the first comment I'd make is that Marine Directorate has some significant assets in terms of the ships. And so when you're allocating the budget, you can't suddenly cut a bit off a ship. And therefore, as you've got five ships, if the money that you're getting shrinks, you've got less roundabout to allocate. So I think that's the first problem. Some of it are your assets are also tied up in laboratories, which again are fixed assets. I think as far as the who's responsible for what, certainly there were historically heads of science and compliance and the policy areas, and it was at that stage very clear who had responsibility for specific budgets. Obviously, they've gone for a very different structure now, so I can't see exactly who would have responsibility for what. But I think that there is a challenge in understanding what it is that is actually required, as we said, of the Marine Directorate, and who is responsible for deciding what science is going to be done. Is it the people who are going to be the policy leads who are going to be answering the questions to the minister, or is it the scientists? And I think that is a key question. And I think it's a mixture, because as scientists, you want to be looking forward. You want to be understanding the key problems and therefore what has to be done, which is a different perspective to the policy leads. And I do think that the voice of the scientist has diminished and the voice of the policy lead has increased. And so to that extent, I think there is a lack of clarity as to who should be deciding specifically what science is to be done and what budget should be going to science.
Charles.
Yeah, I mean, in terms of your question around sort of engagement around the kind of establishment of the portfolio approach within Marine Directorate, we've had no involvement with that, and I'm not aware of other groups having had it, but they may have done. They can answer to that. So the kind of framework, it doesn't involve like a co-management approach within the Directorate, to the best of my knowledge. In terms of the sort of budgeting and the reporting of it, I think the thing that strikes me, and I've obviously had in the past in different work lives experienced quite a lot of analysis of corporate structures, and it seems to me that there is a curious lack of information around, as it were, the sub-portfolios. We got given the organogram and we have the portfolios, and then there's obviously quite varying sub-portfolios within each of those five main portfolios, and it strikes me as a curious omission not to be able to report to people who are participating in scrutiny on that. And that seems to be something that I would have thought could be reasonably resolved, so that you can actually break down the different entities that are under each portfolio. I mean, it's a granularity issue, which has been obviously been touched on before, but that seems to me to be a sort of logical way to go about doing that.
Thank you. Elspeth.
Robin and then Elaine.
Similarly to others who've responded, there hasn't been certainly much engagement from Marine Directorate to stakeholders in sort of shaping formation of the budgets or how things are structured. I feel in the last few years they've undergone a lot of internal restructuring, which has, and you can see that from the information that was provided, and I think that has been an anchor, if you like, to making progress in some areas, because there's been a great deal of internal restructuring, and I don't think any of us can necessarily see what's different as a consequence of that, other than the structures look a bit different. I don't know if the delivery of anything is different. I think, Robin alluded to this earlier, back when the science part of what is now Marine Directorate was an agency, there was much more transparency about structures and programmes of work. I recall back in the annual report and accounts, all the staff were listed in the structures and the teams that they worked in. There was much more transparency, much more granularity around the allocation of budget. So I think that has been lost with the move to the Marine Directorate. There are some real sort of just day-to-day sort of practical issues. Sometimes you don't always know who to pick up the phone to or where they are, because a lot of the staff still do a lot of home-based working. There's a lot of remote working. It's sometimes quite difficult to sort of corral all the people you need into a room to have a meeting, because sometimes we can do lots of things online, but sometimes it's actually really important to be in the room and to be able to discuss things, particularly when you're having longer meetings or sort of more technical meetings. So I think there's a lot around not just the transparency and greater granular information about the budget and the programmes, but I think also just about how the structures work and how we can make that work best, in not just at a strategic level, but actually also at just day-to-day, to help stakeholders engage better and to help us deliver business better.
Thank you. Robin.
Yeah, it used to be the case that, and I don't know the current arrangements, but all of the scientific work was documented either in the form of a service level agreement, which explained, for example, how data was being collected, where it was going to be used and so on, or research documents, they were called ROANs, which specified specific research projects. And now all that was public information, so anybody could go and get it. And that actually is the sort of information you need here to be able to see exactly where the money's going, you know, what research topics, what science topics it's addressing, and who's responsible. I found it rather remarkable in recent years, I simply couldn't find who was head of science, actually, in Marine Directorate. We have, you know, some information on that now, but as far as I know, that post is located here in Edinburgh, and the staff are all in Aberdeen, or mostly, and it's difficult to understand how you get scientific leadership with that kind of division of responsibilities, where you have frequent changes of head of science. Where's the continuity? Where's the interaction with the staff?
Thank you. Elaine.
Just touch on that, we certainly didn't get involved in that, but I think a lot of people felt that the dropping of fisheries was quite a significant change, because that department no longer is referred to as that. I think we've tried to outline in our association, the Clyde Fishermen's Trust drew up a vision about how we'd like to engage with government and where we think we could help, or what policies we'd like to see taken forward. As far as I know, we're the only association who did that out of necessity, I think. In terms of things like investment and where's it going and the restructure, I mean, I think you had mentioned quite a while ago, Rhoda, actually, I saw your evidence about 6 years ago, you'd mentioned setting up a pace when the MPAs came out. And at the time, we had a three-point plan to assess what was going on socioeconomically in fishing. I personally am not happy with that type of data that's coming out, and I don't know who to speak to about that, because I do think on the ground we're not seeing, there's good people, but I think Phil had touched on the silos and not quite understanding that actually there's the impacts of some of these decisions that are happening, and the amount of consultation that's happening is just, people can't get a breath. And I think that's how we can try and streamline some of that and educate the different departments on the pressures that are on people, and not just within Marine Directorate, also from MCA. We've got compliance issues coming from different areas. And I think it would be good for Marine Directorate to understand those pressures too. Depopulation, lack of crew, all of these things, and how we can work together.
Thank you. Alan.
Just wanted to give a slightly different perspective, I think. I think we've worked really closely with Scottish Government across a range of issues, across a range of strategies and things like that. So I feel I'm really quite well understand the new structures. Salmon and Recreational Fisheries has moved from one part of Marine Directorate into a completely different part, and I well understand that. I know the Deputy Director, I know the team very well, and same with the science function. So, I mean, you have to work at it, but you know, I think we've been lucky enough to be able to put that work in and have that good relationship to understand quite well what's going on. So I just wanted to put that on the record, because it's not I feel that the Marine Directorate are getting a bit of a kicking here. I think they're resource poor and all the rest of it. But as someone said, there's some really good people in there, and they want to do a good job.
Thank you.
Well, I think I had a final question, but I think taking on board Alan's points that it would appear that there needs to be significantly more information about the budgets and other information about the Marine Directorate to help us you know, assess and hold them to account. That information is maybe there, but it certainly doesn't appear to be easily accessible at the moment or in the format that we can take or make conclusions on. But that brings us to the end of the session. Thank you all very much. It's been a mammoth session. The 2.5 hours is come and gone very quickly. It's been hugely useful and will help us when we consider the budget going forward. So thank you all very much. I'll very briefly suspend the meeting to allow your witnesses to leave before moving to agenda item 3.